Hey, let me just tell you something, people. We don't begin to pray and intercede and cry out to God because we feel like it. People have a wrong impression. They think that somehow that the Lord throws you down on the ground, puts his foot on you, makes you feel good. Then that way, that's how you somehow begin to move in him. Some extraordinary whatever. We grab a hold of the truth and we move in the faith and we press past everything. And what happens is we find out that there is a realm that's always accessible. This is reality. I'm not talking fictional Christianity. This is reality. We find out there's a realm that's always accessible. That's the place of the miracle. That's the place of the supernatural signs and wonders. That's the place of faith, great faith. That's the place of interaction with him. That's the place of moving past everything that is demonic, everything that belongs to the realms of the self and of the earthly. God wants to make you strong. He wants you to teach you how to live the life. Hallelujah. That Christ Jesus died for you to have. That the Holy Ghost was poured out upon you so you can function in it. Amen. Don't just sit back. Wait for another day. Hallelujah. Come on, gala say hi, la la bohora. Malangana manja say a rakataya la mosapaha. Marabakara raba say te lebehira. Ha ha ha. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Everybody give a shout to the Lord. Kosa. Sopra. Sepri. Sepri. Do it again. Do it again. Do it again. Makel, Hamrabe, Kapasotaya, Napoya, Sapayo Pasai, Sapayo Lobos, Sapayo Lobokira, Maharabatere Beheya. Hallelujah.
Ha ha! Woohoo! There is none like you. There is none like you.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Oh, there is none like you,
Jesus.
Oh, there is none like you.
Mama Mangero.
There is none like sing your praise. Let all the earth now sing your praise. Let all the earth now sing your praise. Let all the earth now sing your praise. sing your praise. All the earth, let all the earth now sing your praise. Let all the earth, let all the earth now sing your praise. Sing your praise. Let all the earth, let all the earth now sing your praise. Let all the earth, let all the earth now sing your praise. Let all the earth, let all the earth now sing your praise. Let all. The Lord has done. What the Lord has done. What the Lord has done. Look, look at what the Lord has done. Seeing Jesus, the author and the finisher of faith. The one who gives us power to run the race. Look at what the Lord has done. Look and see, look at what the Lord has done. Look and see, just look at what the Lord has done. Look at what the Lord has done.
Everybody give a shout to the Lord. Shout to the Lord of hosts. Shout to the Lord. Shout, 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 shout. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Amazing love. I'll sing of the glories of your way. So sing of the wonders of your grace. Sing of the glories of your way. And in morning and evening and at noon, I will lift my voice to you. Morning and evening and at noon, I will lift my voice to you, Lord. To you, morning, evening, and at noon, I will lift my voice to you, my God. Sing of the wonders of your grace, and sing of the glories of your way. Sing of the wonders of your grace. Sing of the glory of your way. Sing of the wonders of your grace. Sing of the glories of your way. Say your way here. Your way. Your way here, Lord. Your will. Your way. Your will. Your way. Your will, your perfect way here. Your will, your perfect way in me. 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 Your will, your perfect way.
Your will, your perfect way. Your will, your perfect way.
Father, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. That the company of people that are standing in this place tonight, those that are watching by the web, will recognize, Father, that you've given us all the ability that we need to be able to break through, bust through, stand against all the things that would come out to stop us from being who you called us to be.
Hallelujah.
Well, praise God. Everybody say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Woo! Come on, Giru. I'm going to see you. The prophet of God was able to say in a cloudless day, I hear the sound of an abundance of rain. Hallelujah. I pray tonight that you'll stop living the life that you've lived up to this point and live the one that Christ Jesus died for you to have, and recognize that you chose him as he chose you first. In response to that choice, you said you're willing also to no longer live. And so tonight, I'm going to pray in Jesus' name that you're going to get it. You may have a see him and minister to you for a little while, and we'll just watch what God will do for you. You know, I mean, look, there are people that were willing to tear off a roof to get a move of God.
Come on now.
You know, the God has made it very, very clear. Jesus was willing to go to a whipping post and be torn to pieces so that you and I could step into this realm of glory. Somebody thought we were just going to be on some kind of a little vacation, and somebody was going to pamper us according to whatever we thought we wanted at any moment of time. But that's not the way it goes. Jesus Christ died for you and me so that we might die for him. Hallelujah. And we died to him so that we might die for him. And somebody believes that somehow we're out, you know, somehow swimming on the lake, having a picnic. Somebody's got a wrong impression of what's going on around here. Hallelujah. I'm in the middle of a hand-to-hand combat. Hand-to-hand combat with the forces of hell. And this is what God has called us to do. He's called us to lay hold on this wonderful grace he's given and begin to fight a fight. Come on. To war a good warfare. To do endure hardness. Hallelujah. As a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Come on, people, get into the battle. Get out of grammar school, baby school, whatever it is. That get up here into the realm. Get into the good fight of faith. Hallelujah. Manganda suprete asus. You know, I was thinking, you know, if God would have required of us to climb the Himalayas if we wanted to know him, how many people would have been willing? That's good. Then I want you to remember that next time you're going through some kind of a challenge. For which God has already promised you complete and absolute victory. The Father's already promised you absolutely that you're going to overcome. I don't care what it is. I don't care if you get struck with a chest pain tonight and start having a massive heart attack. God has promised, if you know how to move in faith, God's promised you an overcoming power. Hallelujah. You victory. You're going to win. You're not dying. Hallelujah. Because goodness gracious, the Father said, Jesus said, those that believe on me will never see death. I'm never going to see it. Amen. All I'll do, if when I lay down this body, I'm going to step out of this body into another realm. I'll never see death. I'll not know the sorrow of death. I'm not going to lay around convalescing. Christ Jesus is going to come for me. I have a personal promise for him. He said, I go away to prepare a place for you, and I shall come again and receive you unto myself. I take that as a personal promise. I know people that had angels come for them. I'm having Jesus come for me. Hallelujah. I'm going to live out the life that he's got his captivated interest. I'm not going to walk around whining and complaining and crying because I didn't get my way, always being a troublesome child in the house. Come on, people, let's get something done. Praise God. Hallelujah. Yeah, and that's right, because you grab it when you get excited about it. You just sit there all like a frozen idol. Then all you're doing is manifesting that you're serving one. You know, people sit there all idol-like, you know, all frozen up and fossiled over. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Come on, people. Kasate rima. I'm telling you right now, if you were going to go to a place where somebody was going to babysit you and powder puff your pew, you came to the wrong place. Because we over here raising up conquerors. Yeah. Mazakarama. We're raising up those who know how to endure hardness. We're raising up those people who are going to go in authority and faith with signs and wonders and miracles. I'm telling you, everything that Jesus did got him in trouble. Just about everything he got him in trouble. It cost him big time to stand up in front of everyone and say, this day, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. It cost him big time to say, I'm anointed of the Holy Ghost. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. The Holy Ghost is upon me. He's anointed me to preach good news, good tidings. Hallelujah. To the poor. To bind up the broken in heart. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Or proclaim liberty to the captives. Open up the prison doors. To proclaim it. Just to say it's done. I'm going to say it. It's done. I mean, I had a dog one time. I stuck him in a cage. We were in transition. We were moving. He'd always been out on a huge ranch. Stuck him in a cage for a couple of months, 2 months, because we were in transition. We went to get him out. Opened up the cage. He wouldn't come out. The door's open, but he wouldn't come out. He had grown too accustomed to the cage. At first, we put him in there. He didn't want to be in there. But, you know, my goodness, he succumbed to that situation. People, I don't want to see you succumbing, being overwhelmed, yielding to some kind of crazy situation all made up in your head. A universe divined and designed by you. My goodness, who would want to live in that place but you? God ain't gonna live in that realm with you. Ain't living in your sorrow, ain't living in your sadness, ain't living in your badness, ain't living in your madness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's opened up a door, said, come on in. I've got a life. I got a life that you can more than just absorb. You can be filled with. Hallelujah. They want to sit around, wait for God to tickle them, then they'll get happy. And you get happy when you don't feel no tickle. Hallelujah. You have to understand how to push the thing through. You have to understand how to advance the kingdom of God and break through. When everything is against you, nothing's going your way. I'm telling you, the kingdom of God suffers violence, and the violent take it before us. At midnight, after having been stripped down naked and for preaching and whipped publicly for getting out in the middle of this fight, they're thrown in prison, Paul and Silas, chained to a wall. It's midnight. Hallelujah. Some people couldn't even make it here tonight because they were too sleepy. They were a little tired. And they got to get up for work in the morning. What a bunch of nonsense. I mean, come on, man. You're not even in the category of the overcomer when that's going on in your life. When you make your decisions based upon how many hours of sleep you get, whether or not your boss is going to like you when you come walking in the morning. Give me a break. We live in another realm. I don't even know what that realm is. I don't even want to know what that realm is. People would try to tell me about their work schedule. Listen, I tell you right now, I'm a witness against you. I already had the work schedule. I never missed a beat and preached every night. Hallelujah. There's already too many witnesses against you and all the excuses that you have or why you can't do what God's called you to do. And there's too many witnesses. The only one that you've got on your side agreeing with your excuse is you. Are you listening to me? Hallelujah. I want you to get out of the excuses. I want you to get into the fight. I want you to get into the good fight. I want you to understand that there is no concept of you just being able to live out this life of advancing the kingdom of God and not going through what Jesus went through, what his apostles went through. There's no concept of you having it your way and everything going nice and easy and good, and you know, you're just everything just, you know, just the way you would have it every day. People tell me, well, I didn't sing because I didn't feel it. Yeah, well, you living in a wrong realm. You're not living under the authority of the Holy Ghost. You're living under the authority of you, and it's about time you face it. Amen. You live under the authority of the Holy Ghost, you know what he's doing. He says, be continually filled. Well, I don't feel like filled. You have to break through everything that would stop you, everything that would hinder you. I don't care if you're sick or in prison at night. Listen, I mean, look at what Jesus, they grab a hold of him for announcing such the good news, and now they're going to go and throw him off the cliff. Come on, people. Come on, get yourself in trouble. Get yourself in trouble. You want some more manifest glory in your life? Get yourself in trouble now. Come on. People running, ducking, hiding. Too many people walk up to other people around them. All they're concerned about is whether or not somebody feels good about them. whether or not they're going to be able to make a friend or impress somebody. Come on, people, God's got the ability, going to give you the ability to set them free from the prison that they live in. Why do you want their demon to like you? Because bottom line, if it's just about everything they're doing is out of the realm of the demonic and they don't even need it, know it. They need somebody who can come and proclaim the words of life and set them free. And we've got to break through these things, and there's all kinds of opposition. People, I don't know, man. Why does everybody want to leave, or many of the people want to just leave the fight to a few? Why don't you break through for me and go bring me a cup of water in the midst of the camp of the enemy? Huh? Why? Why don't you go get your own water? Why must we always get you water? Why don't you start going around and getting other people water? We'll get you water. We're going to continue to give you a drink. We're going to continue to show you the ways of life. We're going to continue to tell you about this wonderful realm that you get to live in. But there is a fight that you got to fight. You're going to have to deal with every devil of hell that's come out against you to stop you, that has stamped you, has claimed you, says that the powers of darkness, the demonic realm, believes that they have control over you, and there is no God in heaven that can tell them otherwise, because they're liars, they're pathological liars, they're rebellious against God. They're not listening to anything that God has to say. And it's about time you wake up and quit being moved by, as you yield to, every wind of doctrine, because they on the wind. the wind created by the prince and the power of the air. I want you to just look with me quickly in 1 Peter. I want you to just look here with me. 1 Peter chapter 1. Open up your Bibles up here. The reason I don't usually use my Bibles is because they're all torn up and wrinkled. But I got mine out tonight just to prove to everybody that I do actually open up the Bible. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My verse 11 is completely torn out. Can I have somebody else's verse 11? Is anybody there yet? Hallelujah. Searching water. Let's get this back up here. Oh, the scripture says to us, to you and me, trying to describe to us this great glory, this abundance of life. Oh, my goodness gracious. The life of God, the life of the Spirit, the very life of Jesus, the heavenly realm. Father just make all angels available to us. He made himself available to us, not just available on standby, but come and live and reside on the inside of us, want to walk in us and move in us. And we haven't been willing to contemplate what God has done for us. We're still basically listening to a lying prince of power, powers of darkness and prince and power of the air. And I think that sometimes maybe people aren't even listening to, they're not even at that cut yet. They're just listening to the imaginations of their head. Yes, troublesome times will come. But you know what you do when troublesome times come? You get radical. You don't just get passive, you get radical. It's a war. You don't lay down to sickness. You don't lay down to bad attitudes. You don't lay down to some kind of a financial issue. There is a way to break through. I'm going to tell you right now, you don't go knocking on doors. You don't go calling people on the telephone. You begin to lift up your voice. You begin to shout unto the Lord. You begin to deal and confront with the thing that is literally trying to work within the midst of your attitude. People, I want you to understand the confrontation is not something that is going on, some war that is going on inside of us. It doesn't even work that way. It is an interface between the greater one that is in us and the one that is in this world. And you're going to have to understand, you're going to have to enter into a spiritual conflict and stop letting attitudes and behaviors and disappointments and discouragements and fears stop you, because you're never going to go anywhere in God that way.
That's right.
You're never going to live in divine health that way. Amen. You're never going to live in divine blessing that way. You're never going to live in divine authority that way. You'll never have what God says until you're willing to pour out all your life for what? Listen, pour out all of your life. Paul said, I poured out my life as a drink offering. My life has been poured out as a drink offering unto the Lord and unto you. And look at what happens when you've got that kind of consecration. Look at the the conflict that Jesus went through just in the wilderness to begin the ministry. Look at the conflict that he went through in the garden. Who was willing to go with him through the conflict? Who's willing to get past their issues, their weaknesses, their lack of the display of God in their life by simply giving themselves to fasting and prayer until something happens, something breaks inside their spirit? Very few. Very few. That's the sad reality. Very few. And as I'm telling you right now, and I believe tonight that I'm speaking to the very few, and you think that I'm going to be happy watching you be anything other than the very few, you're making a mistake. You don't know who I am. I will not be happy while people just walk all over the blood of the Lamb, while people act like God in heaven isn't real, when they'll act like the salvation that he's given somehow is not relevant to them. All the while, God has no witness in the earth, nothing more than just a Christian or religious person. Come on, people. It's time you and I understand. We are engaged in a conflict that we cannot possibly in any way be successful unless we're strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. And that comes by an active force of your will and consecration of your life. Jesus, what he went through in the Garden of Gethsemane is something that he's invited you and me to come on into. Amen. With him in. Thank you, Lord. Where he begins to pray and cry out and intercede on our behalf and sanctify himself that we may be sanctified in him. When he begins to go through all of the agony and all of the intensity as he's battling against the powers of darkness and all of the realm of self that would try to keep him from the cross. And he says, come follow me. I don't know what, You got a wrong impression of what this is all about. Huh? Some people think that walking with God is about coming in a church, laying on the floor, and laughing the whole time. And if they're laughing the whole time, then they're flowing in the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you right now, flowing in the Holy Ghost is when you're driving out devils. Hallelujah. You're setting captives free. You're risking your life to be put in prison or whatever else, you know. I mean, you look at the shout and the praise and the worship, and look at the breakthrough there in Paul's life and Silas's life. As they, you know, I mean, just totally humiliated. Grown men stripped naked in public, beat, chained to a wall at midnight. What do they find them doing? Worshiping and praising God. Hallelujah. There's a breakthrough. I'm telling you right now, people have not learned how to engage their voice and their passion. The first place that the rivers of God will issue forth from is our passions and our emotions. And until you allow your passions and emotions to arise up in God, see, you're just not hungry enough. You're not willing to climb the Himalayas. You're not willing to go to the cross. You're not willing to go to the garden. You're not willing to understand the altar that God has made of your life. You want it to be the other way around. Jesus came and showed us how we're supposed to live out our life. How we're supposed to live out our life for one another. People are always wondering why somebody isn't taking care of them. No, God called you to take care of everybody else. He showed us when he took towel and basin in hand and he washed the disciples' feet. And I mean, when he came to Peter, Peter's going, you got to be kidding me. He's basically saying, you're washing my feet. He's saying, you think you're going to wash my feet? Because in their custom, that was something that belonged to the lowest slave. Not even a Jewish person was supposed to do that, because you're touching someone's feet. Get a Gentile slave to do that. Jesus showed us how to serve one another. And you know, this is the ministry of the living God. He showed us how to come and begin to deal with everything that has to do with pride and rebellion. And I got to have it my way, and you don't tell me. He showed us how to walk in a place of brokenness and humility. Hallelujah. When you get over into humility and brokenness, you know what? Control's not even in your world. It's not even in your vocabulary. Huh? So having to be obedient to someone's not even in your culture or thought process. You just live as a servant. Hallelujah. Jesus over and again just saying, I came to serve, not to be served. We got it all upside down. People, it's time we begin to start following the Lord Jesus Christ, do it his way, and start gaining ground. Because I'm telling you, as long as you got arrogance and pride, you're going to do it your own way. Satan's got more on you than Jesus does. Amen. You're just going to have to listen to it. The church can't move into the greater works simply because they're not willing to move into the lowliness and meekness of Christ Jesus, which the Holy Ghost has come to show us how to do. I mean, this is a great defense against all of these things. If you'll be clothed with humility and walk in love, Satan can touch you. He can't touch you. Because the bottom line is most of what Satan does is he tries to access us through the areas of our life that we are like him. That we'll act like him. And once again, that is an interface between the greater one that is on the inside of you and the wickedness that is on the outside of you. God is there. He's willing to take full control of your life, but you've got to give him permission. You've got to be willing to obey him. He's not going to force you. He's not going to be as Satan is, who would impose his will upon you. And that interface of the Antichrist spirit, that interface of the, which is literally the power of darkness that has come to make sure that nothing of Jesus Christ is manifested in your life. He's going to play on the things that are not submitted in your life to God. He's going to play on every area that yourself demands your own will and your own way. Jesus said, I do nothing of myself. This is how the anointing works. This is how heaven works. It's not, I'm under the rule and the authority of the Father. I do what he tells me to do. I go where he tells me to go. I say what he tells me to say. I'm laying down my life. I want you to come and follow me. Deny yourself and lay your life down too. This is the way it works. People want to have the things of heaven and do it some other way. They want to chart their own course and end up where God has called us to be. Ain't gonna ever happen. It's time for you. It's time for God's people to come under the rule. The rulership, the sovereign rulership that people will say, Jesus is Lord. Is he your ruler? Because Lord lost its meaning somewhere. Lord is the one who has mastery over you. You don't have your own life. You are a serf in their realm. You do what they tell you. You live by their own good grace. You get to eat because they allow you to eat. You get to live in a house because they afford you one. Are you listening to me? Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on now. Hello. Hello. I mean, I want you to get active over here. I want you to start grabbing something. I want you to start looking like somebody's alive. I want you to come on now. I want you to say, I want these things in my life instead of ducking and hiding. Listen, I watch this over and again. I watch it over again. The voice of the Lord goes forth and people run and hide in fear and shame just like Adam. Listen to me. Man, it's time for you to hear the voice of the Lord and run to his arms. It's time for you to understand you being trained to endure hardness. You being trained to be equipped to deal with spiritual wickedness. The things that were, and the reality of it is, you're never going to be used any more than you are right now until you will be willing to deal with the things the way that God has described for us to deal with them. Until you understand how to just basically praise when you don't feel like praising, shout when you don't feel like shouting, get totally aggressive over anything that's being imposed upon you that is not of God. Amen. Hallelujah. And when you do, and you begin to shout, and you begin to lift up your voice, you're going to have the move of God. The earthquake's going to come. Your chain's going to fall from you. The jail cell's going to be opened up. Hallelujah. And you're going to start living the life. You're not going to worry about your finances anymore. You're not going to worry about your job anymore. In fact, you're not going to worry about any part of your life anymore. For you to live as Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. To understand, I no longer live. I mean, you don't get to wrap your heart around that till you embrace and accept that God has given you his life. Hallelujah. You're not any part of the kingdom of God until you start living the life of Jesus. You're not part of the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is about receiving the life of Jesus and living the life of Jesus. And all we've got is a bunch of posers and pretenders. And it's about time for the floodlight to shine so that everybody can have a distinction between those who are of God and those who are of themselves. Just the way it is. I'm here to tell you, I am absolutely set on running off every wolf, every devil, every demon spirit. And nobody can force you. You have to obey. You have to do what you're told to do. When somebody tells you to shout, you need to shout. Until you can do it on your own. Well, it won't be long. You'll grow up and you'll know how to shout on your own. Praise God. Hallelujah. It won't be long and you'll discover, my goodness, all I had to do was agree with God, obey God, and the anointing of the Holy Ghost, the very presence and power of God was activated in my life, took over, and the flood of heaven began to overwhelm my soul. And the sickness and the disease that was there had to go. Hallelujah. And the opposing things that were trying to rip me off and steal from me and kill me. That's all Satan does is steal, kill, and destroy. And he's constantly ripping people off through their attitudes. They're constantly ripping people off because they're not willing to obey. Hallelujah. Nambakas. You don't go and take nations. You don't walk into places like Cuba that has been under the prince of the power of the air and fortified against any gospel message. You don't walk into places like Kashmir, Nepal, unless you know how to do yourself some good fighting in the spirit. Because you're going to have to face every one of your issues, every one of your challenges, every one of your weaknesses, every area of your rebellion, every area of your disobedience, every area of wanting it your own way. To come to realize, wait a minute, I don't even live anymore. What are we talking about, all these things? No, people, the reality of it is you constantly allow yourself to choose to live out a different life than the life that God has given for you. Only simply because you're not willing to agree with God every day that God lives here. This is his life. I mean, my goodness, we're so tired of seeing people backslide, come back to the Lord, backslide, come back to the Lord, backslide. You know what I'm saying? We'll come back to the Lord by Sunday evening, and then by Monday afternoon, they're backsliding again. Living out their own life. Are you listening to me? I pray in the name of Jesus Christ tonight that you will rise up and you will begin to do the things that Father has given you to do, that you will begin through prayer and worship and praise just the things that belong to your passions and your emotions and your attitudes, to have nothing in them except for it is defined and brought to you by God the Holy Ghost right out of heaven, and it looks just like Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, when Jesus said that the rivers would come, he said they would come out of your kolia. That's talking about your passions and emotions. That Greek word can only be understood by way of passions and emotions. So he's telling us that's the first place that the river flows. And I've seen people that have been touched by the Lord, and they've been, many of you here, and you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost and with the evidence of speaking in tongues, but you've never let it go beyond just this little casual little, you know, a sound that comes out of you that really doesn't take much energy at all. I guess you're saving all the rest of your energy up for all the stuff you got to do for you. Are you listening to me? Why don't you just start spending all of your energy and your strength on God? Why don't you start worshiping God with all your strength? Huh? I can't even get hardly anybody to clap and say amen. I get a few nods. Come on, people. Come on, look like heaven. Come on. Come on, look like heaven. I mean, get excited. I mean, I'm telling you, you don't understand. This is what's going to make the difference when you're not going to sit back in silence. Satan wants to shut you down. He wants to shut your mouth. The only time you're allowed to open up your mouth is to complain. The only time you're allowed to open up your mouth is to murmur, to speak out some kind of doubt. Otherwise, you're shut down. It's about time you start understanding that it isn't too hard, not too difficult to look at where the battlefront is and decide whether or not you're going to get in to the wonderful and glorious good fight of faith and begin to take some ground here. Hallelujah. You know, if I'm sitting in somebody's meeting and they say, who's going to look like God? I'm going to go, it's me right over here. Somebody said, who's going to walk in the Spirit? I'm over here, right here. I'm going to walk in the Holy Ghost. Because I'm interacting with the Almighty God in this place. Hallelujah. He's in me and he's with me and he's watching right now. He's receiving the things that I'm giving. I mean, I tell you, when I preach, I always have Father, Son, and Holy Ghost on the front row, and I'm seeing how they're responding to what I'm saying. Hallelujah. Everybody else doesn't really even matter so long as they're going. That's right. And his word is telling us, people, his word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. We know what we're supposed to do because of what his word says. You can opt out of walking with God. You can continue on walking with the powers of darkness, living in sin. You can continue on being under the realm of curse and depression and hate and misery and sorrow if you want. But Father has an abundant life. He's calling you to come on into a joy, a love, a peace, a heavenly realm. I'm going to tell you, until the world begins to see this life in the midst of the church, nothing's going to change. It's just going to be more religion. It's just more religion. You changed. You already changed. You already changed. Hallelujah. You done. Now you got to will it. Now you got to will it. Now you got to let God. You got to let God arise. You got to say, wait a minute, I know who's here. See, it's a faith shut down at its very almost germinated state. I would say a seed, but it's more than a seed. It's germinated. It's faith shut down at a germinated state when you're not willing to break past the things that are contrary to what God said you are and what He says He's given you. Come on now. And it's just time that you recognize that that's not going to come because you feel good or you feel bad or you need something and you need some comfort. Huh? Come on, people. Hallelujah. God's got an army. Hallelujah. Not a social club. Hallelujah. He's raising up a mighty army. Look at what they look like. They got faces like lions. They kind of look like this right here. Right here. They run like horses. No, walking through the, tiptoeing through the tulips or walking through the garden in the evening. This is run. This is a full-out run. It's a full-out race. I mean, I'm telling you right now, the lives weigh in the balance. The fight is because Satan is determined that no similitude of Jesus Christ will be seen on earth. No similitude of Jesus Christ will be seen in you. He don't mind religion. But the life and the power of Jesus, I'm going to tell you right now, there are sometimes I look and see more as it were fruits of similitude of God in the Jewish community or the Buddhist community. It's about time God's people recognize, wait a minute, why is it that we're having such a challenging time and a hard time? It's because you've never dealt with the reality of the powers of darkness that have come out against you, that Father has made us more than equipped to be able to deal with. I'm going to tell you right now. I know in 1 John 4:4, the scripture says, don't believe every spirit, but try the spirit, for many false prophets have gone out into the world. You need to try your own spirit. Huh? Because the spirit that is of God overcomes the world. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And if you're not doing any overcoming, you got yourself a wrong spirit. Hallelujah. Pointing the fingers at the person that's preaching, trying to deliver the word of God to you. Trying to show you how to stand up and fight. Show you how to stand up and war a good warfare. Show you how to stand up and with the authority of God, with the strength of the Lord and the power of His might, have all power and authority over every unclean spirit, power and authority over every devil and over every sickness and disease. Hallelujah. Power and authority over every devil to cast them out, and power and authority over every sickness and disease to heal them. Both say, you're not getting into that unless you're willing to go all the way with Christ Jesus, forsake those things which you hold on to and that you gain your security from and that you identify your life out of. You're going to have to forsake that and come follow Him or you're never having any of it. Hallelujah. People ask me, all the time, well, why don't you take a bigger team with you to different places? Man, I'm telling you right now, when it comes to looking around and see people who can go into that kind of arena, I look around and go, man, if I take people into that with me, they're going to fall out. They can't handle their own problems in their living room. What are they going to do when they're trying to be up here in the interface of taking a nation and dealing with the prince and the power of the air? That has authority over that nation. You're going to have to get yourself on your knees, on your face, crying out to God. Get yourself some display of the power of God. Otherwise, you're not doing anything.
You're just not. Because we can do nothing of ourselves. There has to be the display of Jesus Christ in our life. We're going to have to understand the difference between our life and His life, between the heavenly life and the earthly life, between the things of the Spirit and worldliness. The Bible wants to walk in you and live in you and dwell in you. You and I are going to decide how much that's going to be. And it's your will, and it's what you purpose to do. And I know that I could give you a lot of different examples in life. Huh? You know, there's a lot of challenges just in the natural, in your workplace. There's so many things that you're up to the challenge. You're up to push through. You're up to do whatever you got to do to keep the job. You're up to do whatever you got to do to get your body in shape. You're up, some of you. You have to do whatever you got to do, you know, to reach your goals. But they're all earthly and meaningless and have no value whatsoever. Some of you spent more than half your life in school studying 12, 14 hours a day. I'm telling you right now, God needs them people to be consecrated to Him that way. God needs them people that aren't going to bend nor bow, going to do it every day, just like He said to do it, no matter what comes your way. I'm telling you right now, when I see sickness and disease around me, you know what rises up on the inside of me? The holy indignation of God. I get intense. And you know what I do? I usually praise louder, shout louder, worship louder, preach louder, because I'm going to deal with every force of hell. I'm taking it out. Amen. Hallelujah. And I want you to start throwing in a little bit so I don't have to do all your stuff for you. Yeah. I don't mind, but come on. Like, let me get you done so I can move on to somebody else and you can move on to somebody else. But to continually have to get all your stuff for you for the rest of your life is not the Bible program. It's not the gospel program. Hallelujah. You're supposed to, I'm here, James is here, God raised up people to perfect you. But if you don't cooperate, you get no perfection. To build you up, get you strong. But if you don't cooperate and do what you're told to do, you're not passing first grade. You listening to me? You're not passing any of the tests. We're telling you what to do to be able to pass the test. Yes. Hello! Yeah. Are you listening to me? Yeah. I understand. You don't get it. I get it. You don't get it. I understand the conflict that rages against us right now because of what we're getting ready to do. You guys, many of you are participating with sending me with your finances to places that have not ever had the gospel preached to it in some instances, that are in strongholds, people who are out in the way furthest outreaches of society, who've got no one to come and tell them how to move in the Holy Ghost and take a hold of this glorious liberty. And then, you know, you're wondering, why are these things coming at you right, left, and center? It's just like a blindfolded person that don't get it. Hello. I want you to take the blindfold off. I want you to hit your knees and quit struggling, trying to find some time to talk with God. It is nuts. People struggle to find a time to talk with God every day. My goodness. What? To talk with God. Not some religious little prayer thing. I'm talking about talking, communing with God. Learning how to talk to Him so that you can talk on His behalf. You learn how to talk to God, and the prophecy and the word of faith that will come out of your mouth will be His. Hallelujah. So I pray. Come on, people. I would like to see... A complete 100% turnover within the next year. All of you are on the mission field, evangelistic field, doing something somewhere. Hallelujah. And somebody else has got your chair. But I'm going to tell you right now, you don't get to go anywhere till you get this. God's going to make sure you're stuck. I've been trying to go. You can't go because you haven't got this first principles down. You still are run by your emotions and your attitudes and not by the Holy Ghost. You're still overrun by all the things of circumstance and situation rather than living out the Word of God and saying, I already know what the Word of God is. I already know what He said. I'm going to live it out. I'm not going to birth it out. I'm going to live it out. Hallelujah. Birth it out. He was already born 2,000 years ago. Ain't nothing else to be birthed. Ain't nothing else need to be birthed. Praise God. Hallelujah. People just need to obey God and start moving in what he's already given. Crazy stuff that is going on in the church. Crazy stuff. I'm not going to even talk about it because it's not worth the conversation. Verse 10, verse 9. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Receiving the end of our faith, even the salvation of our souls. Praise God. Everybody go ahead and praise God for a little while. Woo! My goodness. I tell you right now, that's all I got. That's all I got to think about. That's all I got to think about. That's it. I'm going to tell you right now, verses up to verse 9 is enough just to get me all excited about the things of God, that my name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, that I've been saved by Jesus Christ, that he's come to live on the inside of me, that I'm not the property of the powers of darkness.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We just have a Holy Ghost breakdown right there. I think, well, you know what's the problem? Is people got too much information. And so with all that information, they're so confused about where to begin. So maybe we just need to go ahead and erase the chalkboard and just start off with principle one. You're saved. Get excited about it. Just excited about it. Rejoice in it all day long until it becomes a living reality. Until everything about your life has to conform to that reality that you're saved. Saved what? You're delivered. Somebody said, I'm a saved sinner. That's like saying you're a pure prostitute. Hello? Hello? Huh? That you're an honest liar. Give me a break. I'm going to run off the demon spirits that hold men in bondage, the antichrist spirit that keeps Christ Jesus from being revealed. Because until you'll agree with God and believe that he's made you more than a conqueror, that you're an overcomer just as he's an overcomer, that he himself lives on the inside of you, and he's greater than anything that's on the outside of you. And that you're the one who gives permission for anything else to come into you by Jesus. You, and me. And I'm not giving any permission. I got a gigantic no trespassing sign that belongs to the property of God. Hallelujah. I love to tell people over and over again that somehow feels like the battle's too much for them to win. That Job had a little old hedge and Satan couldn't touch him. But we've been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. And you can't even overcome a stick demon who's paralyzed from the neck down, blind in both eyes, deaf in both ears, and has an IQ of 0.1. Hello. Come on now. Come on now. In the name of Jesus. You better find out whether or not the greater one lives on the inside of you or not. Because the Lord gave us power and authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy so that nothing could by any means hurt us. That is the definition of someone saved. Father gave to us a wellspring springing up on the inside of us so that we would desire nothing else in this world. And that is his definition of those who are saved. The rest of it comes down to our will. What are we willing to accommodate? Huh? What are we willing to allow? Somebody gets sick and we allow fear to take over us and we say, no, we got to take care of this right now and whatever. Huh? Or sympathy, human sympathy kicks in. Oh, no. What are we going to do? That's why Israel couldn't go into their inheritance. They were all caught away in the need, their own needs, their own self-interest, and especially concerned about their children, because somehow they felt that they had more love and compassion and care and concern for their children than God Almighty did. Give me a break. They didn't go into their inheritance. They rebelled against God, and their carcasses died in the wilderness. When God brings the word carcass out, that's what I'm telling you right now. That's serious rejection right there. When your body turns into a carcass, that's it. Their carcasses died in the wilderness. And God tells us that we better take note. We better learn a lesson. Hebrews chapter 3 and Hebrews chapter 4. I'm going to keep you out of hell if you stay in here. I'm going to keep you out of hell if you stay in here. You listen to me. I'm going to keep you from the grip of the powers of darkness if you'll listen. Huh? You come in here and you leave, it's going to take you years of counseling from your priest or whoever to get over what I've said to you. And there ain't no getting over it ever. Hallelujah. It'll ring out in your ears, but my voice will ring out in the sound of your hearing throughout an age without end in a place called torment, the lake of fire. This is true. This is serious business. And God's people have got to recognize, every one of you got to recognize that you bring either something that is belonging to Christ or you bring something in here that is antichrist. You bring in something that is going to cause the Holy Ghost conviction to grab a hold of people so they cannot move out, or you're going to bring something in here that works against that so that people never know whether or not they've had an encounter with Jesus. God wants you to come into a place of walking with Him, that every one of you prophesy, and the prophecy that He wants is His word coming out of your mouth that is sharper than any two-edged sword, that is a discerner of the thought and the intent of the heart, so that when every one of you prophesy, then those come in that do not believe will fall down in the place and say, God is truly here, because the thoughts and the intent of the heart has been revealed. Come on, people. Come on. You're never going to do anything for God in the realms of the anointing beyond what you've been willing to participate with in His house, because this is where it's resident. This is where it's gifted. This is where it's handed out. This is where you're matured in it and grow in it. This is where you're instructed in it. And everybody in this place is without excuse. If you were in the Baptist church, you would have an excuse on that day. If you were in the Lutheran church, you'd have an excuse on that day. If you were in a playing games church with God, you'd have an excuse on that day. But in this church, you have no excuse. Amen. To continue to live out a mere life of human existence without the power of God. Father has given to us a divine power and a divine ability. He's given us everything that we need, everything that pertains to life and godliness. He's given it to us because He's called us to glory and to purity. He's called us to glory and to virtue. He's called us to live in the kind of glory that He Himself has. People, it's time for us to absorb and take a hold of the things of heaven and allow the glory to flow out of us. That somebody's got to have their face veiled in the place. People, it's time to get a hold of God and start pressing into a realm that it might cost you fasting and praying. It might cost you expense of doing your own will and having your own way. But if you'll seek Him, I'm telling you, Father is calling out. His voice is lifted up. He's calling out to the sons of men, looking for anyone, calling for anyone who will seek Him. Yes. Who will lay hold on all those things that belong to His life, which is eternal life, the life of God, the life of the Spirit. That 120 were able to change the world with. Somebody said there's over 700 million Holy Ghost filled people on the planet. I doubt it. 120 changed the world. People, listen, there's 3 billion people who've never heard, and there's plenty of airplanes flying in their direction. I'm going to say that again. There's 3 billion people who've never heard, and there's plenty of airplanes flying in their direction. And then when you get there, there's cars. And you can drive. I want to ask you a question. When Pastor James said today, how many of you asking God for a nation? I wasn't the only one that raised my hand, was I? No. How many of you raised your hand? 2, 3, 4 people? At least, praise God. What's wrong with the rest of you? Is it broke? Is it out of socket? Have you got a torn rotator cuff? What's wrong? Where's your heart? Where's your faith? There's not two ministries of Jesus. It's the ministry of Jesus. The ministry of Jesus. He will give me the nations for my inheritance, the heathen for my inheritance, the uttermost parts of the earth for my possession. You're going to have some other ministry, some other faith than the one of Jesus? That's your problem. Get in agreement with God. Get in agreement with God. Make His heart, make His vision, make His purpose yours, and you won't be all led astray with all your other stuff sitting around sucking your thumb over your own loss and your own issues. Give me a break. Come on. Hello. Basakaramaya. Hello. Bravataya. I want you to Mandalay Vashikaya. Mambrasaya. I want you to get big in God. I want you to let God get big in you. Hallelujah. He gave us the authority to be His sons. He gave us the authority to be His sons. He gave us the authority to live out the very life of Jesus, the overcoming life of Jesus, to live out the same power, the same glory, the same relationship. And you can't find time to talk with Him. And you don't know the power that overcomes the world. And you don't understand how to flow in that which is supplied to us like rivers. Interesting. Are you listening to me? Huh? I mean, if it was some little teeny creek somewhere, it might be hard to find on a given day. But it's rivers, man. It's like you can't mistake rivers. You're living, it's rivers are on your property. You know what I'm saying? We get by the rivers. Hallelujah. I pray in the name of Jesus that you'd be more successful the next time you go through another battle. Because me hollering and screaming at you basically ended yours today. Huh? But I hope the next time you'll end your own. And you'll go ahead and understand what it means to go through something. And having done all to stand and get passionate about having it God's way, no matter what you got to do, no matter what's up against you. Yeah. I mean, you know what? The Lord talks about this, that consistent petitioning prayer that doesn't let up, that is going to say, get up and get this for me now.
Yeah.
No, he does. He does. He said, this is what I want. I want you to be like a person who's banging on the wall. Get up! Get up in there. Get up. Get up. I need this. I need you to get this for me. This is a Jesus message. This isn't Paul's message. This isn't Peter's message about Jesus. This is Jesus' message about himself. And he says, will the Son of Man find such faith on the earth when he comes? Will there be anybody who knows him like that? Who's in partnership with him? Like, come on, yeah, that's God. Thank you. I got one yes, praise God. One yes. Everybody else is still in fear. Get out of your fear. Get out of your fear. Get out of your restraints. Get out of your chains. Hallelujah. Three claps. Praise God. Three claps. Hallelujah. Because it really is. It's a spiritual thing. Clap unto the Lord. This is a shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. Clap your hands, all ye people. Now, hey, listen, the world stole it from us. It belongs to us. It's a spiritual expression of divine agreement with God. I'm going to agree with God. If you do not agree with God, you lose. You lose. You go without. You blind, naked, wretched, poor, and miserable. That's true. There's a lot of miserable, wretched people in the church. Why? Because they're not willing to agree with God. Now, that's Jesus' message. Those of you looking at me somewhat cross, that's the lowly Lamb of Galilee, and no one can question his love for you and me. Hallelujah. I'm just preaching his sermon. Hallelujah. I want to build within you a resolve of faith that is so aggressive and so violent that you're not willing anymore to have anything in your life if it doesn't look like what God described and what the Holy Spirit has given. It comes down to the force of your own will. It's the force of our will. Come on, Jesse. And I'm going to tell you right now, it looks like a cross. It looks like a cross. The denial of self at many times looks like a cross. Here is Paul's cry, that I may know him in the fellowship of his suffering. This is what it means to walk with Christ Jesus, to want to know him in the fellowship of his suffering and be made conformable unto his death. What? No, man, I wasn't going. I'm in the wrong shop. I was looking for some fun stuff. I was looking for some things that would just give me a thrill, make me feel high. Jesus is like the best drug I ever taken. You know what? You are weird. Because there's just simply no relationship between Jesus and the drug that you took or whatever. Give me a break. That was some burnout hippie that said that in the Jesus movement. And since then, it's been verified that it's just absolutely not true. It was actually verified before that, but no one was listening. You're going to have to get the Word of God in you. If you don't have the Word of God in you, how are you going to overcome the wicked one? I write unto you, young men, and my, if there's ever a time, I mean, I'm telling you, and I'm crying out to God, and I'm going to continue to cry, and I know that He will hear and answer me. But there has to be a company of those who are young men, young women in the world. I write unto you, young men, because you're strong, and you've overcome the wicked one. Why? Because the Word of God abides in you. In other words, you stay continually in agreement with the Word of God. You say, I'm not having it in my life. God said something totally different. I defy everything that is unlike God. I defy everything that would try to bring my emotions, my feeling, my processes of thinking, what I believe about myself, what I believe about the world that I live in, what I believe about my relationship with God. I defy it. I cause it in Jesus' name to come under the authority of the blood of Jesus Christ and to bow to His Word, the living Word and the written Word that expresses who the living Word is. This is the decision you have to make. When you wake up in the morning and you're a little tired and you're sleepy, I know that you basically have learned how to rely upon natural things for that which you feel you need to get going. But I want you to know there is a place of worship and praise. I'm telling you right now, I came in here this morning with a definition. I'm not playing around with no sickness, no problems, no diseases, no afflictions, no spirit of anything that doesn't belong to God messing with anybody in this house. Hallelujah. And determined also to make sure that you understand that this is a front against you, and you have to realize that the Father wants to perfect the things that concern you and show you how to begin to move in His strength and His might and His power, how to be able to stand up against all these things that are coming at you, how to contemplate and appreciate all that Father has given you so you'll quit being conformed to you. If you could just see something better than you. Hallelujah. If you could just find a treasure better than what you got. If you could just find a pearl better than what you have. You'll sell everything to go get it.
Yes.
Hallelujah. True. To just begin to contemplate and realize that the life of God is yours. It's yours.
Yeah.
It's yours 24 hours a day. Even on Monday morning when you get up and you're tired and you've got to go to work and you're dragging out of bed, the glory of heaven, the power of God is yours. But you have to agree with God. You have to recognize Him. You have to acknowledge Him. You have to give place to Him in your life. It's time for you. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, I love the Church of China. I didn't get to go last year. But the Church of China is doing what they're doing because they're such a troop. They have lived their whole life, and their whole culture is about, really, it's very kingdom-like because of the kind of government that they've lived under. And about every sentence and a half, everybody, to the top of their lungs, says as loud as they can, Amen. No, it is radical. It's like there is an invisible conductor telling them, do it now. It is precision. There is nobody not participating. You don't see anybody sitting there going. And I'm telling you, Amen is just simply a verbal Hebrew agreement that says, I agree with you, Lord. That's the way it's going to be. That is absolutely true. I'm going to do that. All of those things that I just said is a way that you could define that statement, that amen. Like hallelujah is far more than what people understood. It's praise the Lord. Hallelujah. It's rejoice in the Lord. Hallelujah. It's the Hallel. To do the Hallel, you've got to actually dance. You got to do the Hallel. You got to not only just say something with your mouth, but you got to do something with your feet and the rest of your body too. Hallelujah. The Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to let God begin to feel your passions and your emotions. Because if you don't, you're going to allow other influences to begin to overwhelm your passions and emotions. They're wrong influences. God wants a river flowing out of you. Once again, this is not some struggle on the inside of you. This is an interface between the greater one that is in you and the one that is in the world. And it's about high time people stop backsliding every other day. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, just go ahead and clap about it. Amen. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, I want you to learn what I've learned. I've learned that when the enemy's coming out against me, when he's trying to shut me down and stop me, I dance. I mean, I'm going to tell you right now, I dance. I don't just sing, I dance, and I don't just dance. I get radical with it. I lift up my voice. I shout louder than at any other time. I preach louder than at any other time. I sing louder. I praise louder. I cry out louder. I'm not letting anything else on the inside of me or influence me or my mind or my thinking other than God. Now come follow me, because this works, and you can prove it in the scripture. You listen, I'm telling you right now, I'm going to go to India. I'm getting ready to go to India. I got to break that Hindu thing off everybody wants to sit around all quiet and everything. Because that's not the way of the kingdom of God. It might be the kingdom of men. It's not the kingdom of God. Kingdom of God is shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of Satan, no emotion, no passion. Kingdom of God, a Holy Ghost display of emotion and passion and determination and joy and love and celebration. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Now, see, we're just accustomed to live in an oppressed, depressed world in a sedated state of the demonic. I said a sedated state of the demonic. That's right. Sedated by demon spirits. And it's normal to us to see everybody sitting around going. And then the movies we want to watch is people cutting everybody's head off. Somebody in disaster falling into a pit screaming, ah! That's what we want to pay for. Things of that nature. See, devastation and disaster. The more devastation and disaster, the higher the ratings. The more money they're going to make off of it. Why would we feast on that? Why would we feed on death and destruction and hate and turmoil and lust? That's a display that there's a wrong desire in you. I tell you, that's not what God brought forth in the new birth. And your experience with God better match up the new birth with the new birth. Otherwise, your experience is wrong. You need to get right with God. And stay right with God. And understand that He's given us supernatural power to live this life and to walk this thing out. Hallelujah. I mean, come on. I mean, we've got to demand it of ourselves. We've got to demand it of the Lord who's given these things and wants us to have them. But He's going to respond to a hunger and a thirst, a passion on the inside of us. I mean, look at how the Lord doesn't want to see anybody suffer. It's just that He's saying, looky here. This is the way it's got to be in you. You've got to be like a person who's in a desert where there is no water, whose tongue now has swollen in your mouth and faileth for thirst. And when you're that thirsty for me, I'll open up the heavens and I'll pour out everything that I have upon you. Everywhere around you will be a pool of water. People, it is something that happens because we're willing to interact with the Holy Ghost, where He begins to turn our affections and our passions and our emotions and our desire toward heaven, to where Satan and the things of this world have no place to even get one moment upon us. They come and they have nothing in us. God's got a heaven that He's preparing you and I to go to. He's got a glory realm that you and I are being trained to live in, where there is no unrighteousness and there is no sin. And be certain of this, there is no sanctification in the sepulcher. You're not changing because you went into a grave. It's a change that God has made available for you and me right now. And you and I decide whether or not we want that change. And some people have come along and preached another gospel and try to make it like you don't have to change and you don't have to be too serious about it, because God's a God of humanism, secular humanism. And He's just going to accept you like you are. There's no way. He calls you like you are to change you to be like Him. And people, it's just you're going to have to understand it. You're going to have to get serious about God. You're going to have to be willing to be conformed to His image in every dimension of your life. Throughout every situation, throughout every challenge, You're going to have to be willing to look to God. You're at a moment of a test. You're going to have to look to Him and say, Lord, I know that You've got me on this one, and I'm just going to praise You, and I'm going to worship You. And if the thing doesn't disappear, then you just take it up another notch. And now you start dancing. Hallelujah. And you start shouting, and you start praising. And if it hasn't disappeared, well, you just take it up another notch. There's not a person on the planet who's called upon the name of the Lord that needs to have oppressive things going on in their thought life, evil things going on in their thought life, when you can lift up your voice. I'm going to lay hands on some of you tonight, because I'm going to tell you, there is some deliverance that has to go on in the place. I'm going to lay hands on some of you tonight. I'm going to tell you, I might even take a couple of bottles of water and baptize a couple of you. I mean, that's the way we have to do it in China on the run. You just got to grab a bunch of bottles of water and start dumping them over the head. Because there's nothing else. There's no bathtub. There's no pool of water. There's nothing. There's no nothing. There's no puddle. Nothing. Huh? Not even a sink. Sink would be pretty good. I baptize in the name of the Father, Son, the Holy Ghost. I'm gonna listen to me. I hate sin. I hate demon spirits. I hate the powers of darkness. I hate their influence. I hate it when God's people are stupid and allow the powers of darkness to overrun them and shut them down when the greater one is living on the inside of them. I hate that. I hate seeing the one who's got more power get overrun by the weaker one. I hate that. Don't you hate that? I mean, will you hate that with me? Will you hate that with me so bad that you're not allowing that anymore? Come on. I tell you right now, I feel like jumping through the air and tackling a couple of you. Hallelujah. I'm not interested in feel good. There's plenty of feel good in the anointing, but I'm not interested in feel good. I'm interested in doing the will of my Father. Sometimes it looks like a cross. Sometimes it's a Garden of Eden. Sometimes it's a wilderness of being tested and tempted by the devil. Oh, I love the great miracles. I love the great throng of people coming into the kingdom. But listen, it's about doing the will of the Father and recognizing that we have the ability to stand up to whatever's coming at us. As many as have called upon Him, as many as believed, as many rather as we received, He gave them the authority to be sons. And when we talk about the authority of Son, we're talking about that one who sits far above all principality and power and might and above every dominion, who sits in the realms of heaven with absolute authority, and we're seated together with Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When we're talking about the authority of a Son, we're talking about someone who could ask the Father and the Father will hear him and do it. When we're talking about the authority of the Son, it's the power and the ability to speak to the wind and the waves, and they must obey what we say. The reality of it is, you've got to pass the test of not being fearful over the wind of the waves, but understanding who's living on the inside of you, giving Him control over that which you think and your attitudes and your posture and your disposition, and letting Him stand up on the inside of you and teach you how to speak with His divine authority. See, it's as many as believe upon His name. His name is a name that is above every name. I'm going to tell you, in His name, we'll do it all. Hallelujah. Without Him, we could do nothing, but by Him, through Him, we can do all things. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, I love living in love and joy and peace. And that is how, through all my tribulation, I can be exceeding glad. But I'm going to tell you right now, I have gone through situations where God the Holy Spirit is training me to walk in humility and brokenness and lowliness and meekness. And that didn't feel so good. I had to get glad by the force of my will. I'm not so interested in how good I feel. I'm interested in learning how to obey Father and being trained up in everything that belongs to His way and His character and His nature. Because His greater works work out of the realm of His nature, out of the realm of His disposition. All the glory flows through His humility and brokenness. It's not going to flow any other way. We just get a little encouragement, encouraging moments from heaven. Think we're in full-blown revival. You know, it's just, Father, give it us encouraging moments to see if we'll go ahead and follow on and know him. Oh, Rabasataya Maheshe Pakahaya. Nandandaleya Pai. No, I just tell you right now, you know, when we're dealing with things, when we're dealing with things that oppose us, when, you know, when Anna was, and Allie was under the things and the attack that was against their body, when other things happen, you know, we get mad. You can, that's the best way you can say it. We get angry, but it's Holy Ghost anger. It's Holy Ghost indignation. We're not mad at our anger at anybody. We're mad or angry with Holy Ghost indignation at Satan trying to push us around and impose his wickedness and iniquity upon us. If we just recognize our authority, we've created doctrines that believe that to make ourselves believe that somehow that was God's will. Huh? Listen to me. You somehow make it as God's will for us to be sick, or God's will for us to be, you know, sorry and sad and miserable and wretched and naked. You know what I'm saying? And poor. And so therefore, we just acquiesce to it. We just lay down to it. But as soon as we get enough Word of God in us, enough Spirit of God in us to recognize, wait a minute, that is absolutely anti-Christ, that is absolutely opposed to the will of God, suddenly we know where we're supposed to stand. And at least we know where we're standing. Now I know where I'm standing. Wow, it took me 50 years, but now I know where I'm standing. I mean, come on, it shouldn't be taking anybody 50 years. Now I know where to stand. You read the Bible one time and you can get most of this. You now know where to stand. Praise God. Now, all of a sudden, you just got to learn now. You just got to go through one other training, and that is how to trust God. Amen. Two lessons. People spend a lifetime to get two simple little lessons. Know what God wants for your life, and number two, trust him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And then number three is to recognize that he's given you everything that belongs to him. He's not withheld any good thing from you. He's not withheld any dimension of himself. Sometimes I go look in the mirror and say, I see you in there, Lord. I'm not kidding you. I see you. Hallelujah. No, the scripture said, go look in the mirror. Hallelujah. We look in the mirror and behold the glory. Rather, forgive me. We look in the mirror and we behold the image. All I'm seeing is Jesus over here. All I'm seeing is God the Holy Ghost over here. All I'm seeing is Father God over here. I was bought with a price. I'm not my own. I belong to him. He gave me transcendent oneness. He made me one with him. He vested me with everything that belonged to heaven. And I refuse to be anything else. I refuse to be anything else. God's just looking for some people who refuse to be anything else. When God told us to train you, this is the things he told us to train you with. Amen. When Paul understood by revelation that his Father had purposed to reveal his Son in him, he immediately went out into Arabia and received an abundance of revelation and came back and wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. And the whole theme of the New Testament is that God has purposed to reveal his Son in you. Ah, Christ Jesus, his life and his power. Hallelujah. Now you're going to have to start conforming to his image. You're going to have to be willing to walk like him, act like him, obey like him. Amen. And the Word of God tells you what that looks like. Amen. How hard is it to drive out a bad attitude? No, it's very easy. It's very easy to drive out a bad attitude. Very easy. Now if you sit there and say, I told you to go bad attitude. My bad attitude. I got a bad attitude. My, I got a reason to have a bad attitude. You sit there and you debate with your bad attitude. Who knows? You maybe never get out of your bad attitude. You sit there, counsel your bad attitude, think about your attitude, why you have this attitude, debrief on the attitude, huh? Give some explanations on the attitude, repent for the attitude, hope that the attitude goes away. No, it's still there. Oh, no, what are we going to do now? God gave you a river to get rid of the attitude. Hallelujah. He gave you a wellspring to get rid of the attitude. Hallelujah. I know that most people don't get this. It's way over your head. But I pray tonight in the name of Jesus, you grab it by the spirit of wisdom and revelation. And recognize that when you will just turn yourself over to the Holy Ghost, somebody said, how do I turn myself over to the Holy Ghost? I feel so bad.
where do I even begin? I'm just so overwhelmed. I'm just so weak at this. I just can't. I'm no good.
And that's basically the whole thing, the drill of many people's lives, unfortunately. You begin to thank him for all that he's done. You begin to thank him that your name is written in the Lamb's book of life, that he forgives you, that he washed you in his blood, that he filled you with the Holy Ghost, that he gave you love and joy and peace, that he's come to walk in you and live in you, that he's with you. He's your guide. He's your instructor. I mean, there's so much to be thankful for. And then you got that Holy Ghost hooked up with that, and praise begins to express through your life, and shouts begin to come through your life, and you begin to give yourself over to an excitement of all that God has done. And listen to me, no bad attitude can be left after that's done. No bad attitude can remain. Come on, it's just another realm. Now I'm going to kick it into a whole other dimension. Now God gave you a supernatural ability to speak right out of heaven. Not just what people have reduced it to, a charismatic expression called tongues, but the ability to speak by the Spirit right out of heaven, by the power of God, to speak directly to God. My, come on, people who don't have an excuse to ever be overcome, to ever be overwhelmed, to ever find a place of disobedience, to ever have a place of a bad attitude for more than 5 minutes. That's the worst state. That's the worst state. Everybody else should be skilled enough to get it done in 5 seconds. That's just the worst state. If you begin to follow and begin to understand, listen, you know, one of the things that the Lord showed me to do, just to be help me to understand the influences that I was allowing in my processes of thinking. I said, Lord, I want to learn how to fall in love with everyone that I meet in the first 5 seconds, when I learn to fall in love with them. And then in doing so, I had to deal with all the other influences that are trying to impose themselves on us. Satan is a tyrant. People don't get this. Satan is a tyrant who wants to abuse you, who believes he owns you, and that you'll do whatever he demands of you, and God's told you different. Now who are you going to believe? God's told you different and said, I've given you the power to deal with him. Now, what are you going to do? Are you going to recognize the authority that you have? Yes. Well, if you will, I'm going to tell you right now, people, we'll see this region changed. Yes. Where the enemy can't take you out, where all the situations that you face is just an opportunity now for you to gain more momentum in running the race, where all you, whatever trial you go through, all it does is perfect you. Whatever situation you confront that harasses you, you stand there and you just get stronger. You gain more strength, more power, more divine ability. Hallelujah. 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 You come to understand in those situations how to mount up with wings, how to run, not be weary, how to walk and not be faint. Mom does this. That's what that's all about. Huh? Even the young men shall utterly fall, but they that wait upon the Lord. Huh? Those whose confidence, whose expectation, whose desire is towards the Lord, whose trust is in God, who knows that Father is going to come when they call. He's going to answer. He's going to respond at every point of their need. Do you believe? Are you still yet without belief with respect to how Father sees your need? When you listen, people, any person who's called upon his name, who belongs to his kingdom, all heaven's attention is directed right at you when you have a need. Amen. And they're looking at you going, believe, just believe, just believe, believe, just believe, just believe, just believe. All heaven's looking at you. All you got to do is believe. You're sitting there going, there's no way out of this. All heaven's going, please believe. Just believe. Just stand up and declare the word. Just stand up and move in faith. I'll give you the faith. You got about, 10,000 angels laying hands on you while you're sitting there going, God's encouraging you. God, the Holy Ghost is jumping up and down on the inside of you. Hey, I'm here. I'm here. I'm here. Woo! And you're wondering, where's God at this time? People, God wants you to be strong and valiant. We need. Father has listen. He said, "I'm going to go find myself a man. I'm going to find myself a man who has my heart." And so he found a man, and really what he did was he found a man in which he could reproduce his heart in him. David got the same kind of a new heart that saw God. He was a man who was willing to receive. He found a man who had a disposition that he knew would obey him and would walk with him and would move with him and would believe him and would be excited about him and have a great zeal and have a great passion. Listen, we know for certain that David only received a portion, it's a dimension of the Holy Ghost, a dimension of what we would refer to as the Spirit of the Lord. And with that, look what he did. He was so filled with the zeal and the passion of God. He was willing to go down and risk his life as he walked down into the valley to meet Goliath. Because he's not willing to stand for anything going on that is contrary to what God said. You can sit here and you can hide behind the rocks and you can fear and you can tremble and you can worry about what you're going to have to eat tomorrow. But I'm going to go down there and kill that uncircumcised giant. Hallelujah. I got this picture of this real scrawny little 14-year-old. Real scrawny. And it has a good dimension. It's got Goliath about 10, 11 foot tall and big. I mean, his head's like, huge. And here's this little scrawny 14-year-old David in the picture. With a rock, with a little stone. Come on, people. You and I have been baptized in the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hallelujah. We've been given so much more. We've been given eternally more than what David had. We've been given a great cloud of witnesses, a great company of saints declaring to us that we will do this successfully. That if we'll just stand, and having done all to stand, if we'll press through, we'll walk in the same glory, the same faith, the same authority, the same greater works. Do you know when you think about how easy Jesus made it? He said, anyone. I mean, come on, think about it. Wouldn't you like your tomorrow to be saying to the blind eyes open, taking a stroll across the ocean, just walking on the water, just seeing how it feels? Wouldn't you like your tomorrow to be about being translated? I would like to be translated to the Kashmir Valley and back. It would be much better than flying. Wouldn't you like your tomorrow? Can't you see down the road? Can't you see the destination that God has for you, that you should come into the fullness of the measure, the maturity, the ministry of Jesus? Can you see that he's longing for you to come and that he makes it so easy? He says, anyone. He includes everybody and makes it so easy. He says, anyone. Anyone who will believe. These works which I do shall you do, and greater works than these. Anybody who's just willing to believe. And many of the things that you've got to face in this process as you're believing is scary, is threatening, you don't see any way out, and if you look to yourself, you shall surely fail, you shall surely faint, you shall surely go from one moment of being overwhelmed to the next moment of being overwhelmed, to ultimately being just completely cast down and hopeless and despairing. Huh? But if you'll learn how to trust God, because listen, this interface between Christ in me, the greater one that lives on inside of me, who's greater than he that is in the world, and that's how I've overcome. You've overcome them, little children. You are of God, and you have overcome them, for greater is he that is in you than he is in the world. And now here's the interface, though. God didn't take yourself away. And if you're not willing to be taught of God, you're going to always, by default, go to yourself. You're going to default to you to try to solve your problems, to deal with your issues, to work yourself out of whatever thing you're going through, to process with you. But there, resident in you, is God Almighty. And Father's looking for people who will not turn to themselves, but will turn to Him. That's the dimension. That really is the reality of the dimension of what's going on. It's no evil here. It's God's moved in. He's created a new heart. He's created a new spirit. He's given to us that wonderful realm of His divine power and glory where He's come to make His life on the inside of us, His dwelling on the inside of us. I mean, it's almost unspeakable to say. It's like the holies of holies lives in us. But it's our choice of whether we're going to choose to solve our own problems, to look to ourselves, or whether we're going to learn how to lay hold on God and trust Him. This is where Adam failed and Abraham succeeded, and it's the test that you and I are going through every single day. And it's going to make the dimension of whether, it's going to ultimately make the decision of whether we go on and find ourselves doing these works and greater works or not. It can easily be solved. Tonight, I feel revival in the air. I feel the moving of the Spirit in the air. I feel change in the air. I feel the opportunity that is given. God's just waiting for that critical moment where everybody will agree. I mean, when everybody will agree. I figure Pop Seymour knew what he was talking about. He said, when we finally came to a place where I could minister by the Spirit and people would begin to respond to the Spirit of the Lord and everybody came into a place of 100% agreement, God is going to do it. And all the doubt was cast out. Suddenly, Pentecost came. Just like it did in the beginning. We think that it's just, that it's optional. Well, that's one way to do it, but there's many other ways to do it. There's one design. All these things are given to us in the Word of God, and they cannot be compromised. Amen. It's got to be exactly that way. Amen. Then that comes down to a choice of everyone's will. But listen, when we individually learn how to agree with God and to look to God, and every one of us have come to that place in a consecration, in a relationship with Him, then we can do it together. But if we've not ever done it individually, we'll never do it collectively. So therefore, each person bears the same level of responsibility as to whether or not the church becomes a glorious church in this last day or not. Just the way it is. I pray that you get ferocious about it. I pray that no matter what it costs you, no matter what it costs you, cost you your job, cost you your health, and it's not. But no matter, because Satan runs interference. He says it's going to cost you your job. It's going to cost you your health. He's going to go all these things. He's going to get into your head, and you don't have enough word in you to recognize that now you're making decisions out of something that is anti-Christ spirit and that is contrary to the Word of God. You've got to learn how to move in God's Word. Do it His way. We'll get His results. We will get His results. I think bigger than that, every person's got to understand and deal with the reality of where they find themselves on that day with Him. Because this idea that once you've called upon the name of the Lord and you're saved, you're always saved, that is nothing but a lie right out of hell that is completely capitulated by almost every verse of Scripture in the Bible. So people think that they can just do whatever they want to do, and that Father is just going to, He's going to accept that, He's going to accommodate some half-hearted commitment to Him. That is crazy. How can anybody ever believe that over top of even just one message of Jesus? You got to forsake everything. He just said half of stuff, 25%. He said you must overcome like I overcame. You must overcome like I overcame. People don't want that kind of responsibility because all of a sudden it's going to come. They're going to come to a crossroads of decision of whether they're going to live their life or His life. Amen. But you need to come to that crossroads of decision because it's going to make the difference of whether we just continue on charting a course that are constantly being deceived. I mean, there's two choices, two growth plans that Father has. Plan A, the fullness of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus unto a fully matured man. Plan B, little child constantly tossed to and fro by every trick of men. You didn't even get to graduate to Satan. Are you with me? Not every trick of Satan, every trick of men. You're just being pushed around by men. What a life. What a life to forfeit this life of Christ. To forfeit this life of Christ. Father has called you and I to look into our lives and just look into the reality of what's going on in our life and ask ourselves, do I see Jesus? Is Christ in you? Examine yourself. Is Christ in you? If Christ is in you, then you overcome the world. Hallelujah. Examine yourself. Look into the mirror of the Word. Look in and see into these things that Father has made plain to us. We have no veil deception anymore.
Here in 1 Peter, I think I'm still on the same chapter. Yeah, I am. Praise God. This thing held with me after all that bouncing around. Hallelujah. 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 Bon kara na je brusa. Mon le shepaya. Hallelujah. Rombandas. Yeah, on all of our tribulation, we're exceeding glad. But you know what? That's a bigger force of your will. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Mangan all your brusa tana makeya. Hadevenesea. Well, you're going to have to learn how to be exceeding glad in church before you're ever going to learn how to be exceeding glad in all your tribulation. Before you're ever going to learn how to rejoice in the midst of a prison at night, you're going to have to learn how to rejoice in the meeting. Hallelujah. Before you're going to ever get to a nation, you're going to have to learn how to get to the church. Huh? Before you're ever going to flow in the anointing and signs and wonders and power and demonstration on a platform before a bunch of heathens and demons trying to stop you, you're going to have to learn how to flow in the anointing and signs and wonders in the midst of the church. In the midst of this church, all the gifts of the Spirit are resident. There are mantles everywhere to pick up. Everybody can have whatever they want for the asking, so long as you're desiring and seeking and coveting it. You must desire and seek and covet. When you desire and seek and covet, you can't live without it. This is just like hunger and thirsting. Verse 9 says, you've received the end of your faith. I mean, the completion of it, the perfection of it, the fulfillment of it, even the saving of your souls. Hallelujah. Mamastakeya. I believe in soul salvation. There's some people they haven't got their souls saved yet. Boy, go to work on that. I hope that works out for you. poor people, they believe God saved their spirit, but they got to get their soul and body done. Jesus did 1/3, left 2/3 to you. My goodness, you have wherewith to glory then. You know what I'm saying? You get there and say, you only did 1/3, but I got the rest of it done. I got the other 2/3 done. Nonsense. Hallelujah. Whoo, he's abadiah. Soul means your whole being in Old Testament and the New Testament, in both Hebrew and Greek. It means your whole life, your existence. It's not some trichotomization that people want to reduce it to. It means your whole being, your whole existence, your whole nefesh, your whole suke. It's your whole existence, your whole being, having received the saving of your whole being, man. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, I'm the purchased possession. Hallelujah. Woo! I got resurrection life in my bones right here, right now. I'm telling you right now, I got resurrection life in me more than Elisha had. And so do you. I mean, that's why you lay hands on somebody, power of God touches them, because you got resurrection life in your bones. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, but you're going to have to agree with God. You're going to have to get excited about it. You're going to have to rejoice in it. Otherwise, you're never really going to believe it. You're going to have to begin to rejoice in it. Otherwise, you're never going to really believe it. Never really going to believe it. If you can't rejoice about it, you're still wondering, could it be true? That's that doubt look. It is a common look and expression in the Church of Jesus Christ. It's a doubt look. I pray in the name of Jesus, you'll start practicing flowing in the greater works by rejoicing in all the things that God said for you and about you. Hallelujah, that he's done for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I know what's going to happen. I know if you and I will come into agreement with what God wants us to do, that the children's hospital will be cleared out. I'm telling you, it won't take. I'm going to tell you right now, the verifiable miracles of Jesus Christ that can be recorded by any news broadcasting agency will result in the stadium having to be the next church building. The stadium. I'm telling you right now, I'm giving no rest. I'm telling you, I'm aggro about it. I'm telling you, I'm going to press the thing through. I know what's stopping it. It's not God. It's the powers and force of hell that think that they can levy over us their own purpose and will and stop us and make us do whatever they want us to do. And somebody's going to have to get serious about it all and break through. Look, this is just where we're at. Just where we're at. And Father sees the tenacity. He sees the boldness. He sees the desperation. He sees the covetousness. He sees the passion. And I'm telling you right now, it doesn't take. When he sees somebody running right down the middle, he sees somebody running right down the middle. We got this, and we're not letting up. I don't care what happens. I don't care how much failure. I don't care how much crisis. I don't care how much problem. They're running right down the middle. We're going for the goal. I'm telling you, all heaven mobilizes and sets down on that. And we have revival after revival over 2,000 years that proves that that's so. Because somebody laid hold on God. Somebody would not let up. Somebody took it all the way. They didn't just stop with a little bit of anointing. They recognized all that was just enough, a little taste that caused them to want the whole thing. Hallelujah. Come on, Jesse. Hallelujah. I kill snakes. I kill scorpions. I smash them. I don't live with them. I don't allow them to hang out. I don't say, hey, they have a right to live too. They don't have no right to live around me. And have no right to live around me. Hallelujah. One day, Josiah, he was a little guy. He's walking out on a ranch property and he's walking towards the door of the house. And the dog was over there, yep, 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 just bark it away. I was out doing something. Finally, what is that dog yapping about? And here's a rattlesnake, and his head was up, and he's coming right for Josiah, right from behind him. You know what we did?
Killed him.
We killed him. Oh, no, you should have picked him up and thrown him away. Yeah, so he could sneak back around and bite one of the kids and kill him. Now, listen, I'll tell you right now. That is just an example, because I know some of there might be people in here might be snake lovers. You're weird. I'm going to tell you, weird. Okay? Serpents. Listen to me. Give me a break. Get yourself another pet. Get a rabbit or something. I mean, a lizard. A gecko, whatever, something. Jesus. Listen, people, we're not going to cohabitate with anything that has, if it is not what God has described, it's a realm of the demonic. I'm telling you right now. It truly is. Satan is serious about what his objective. I'm telling you, he literally charges the atmosphere of this planet with the things that he's purposed to do. The good news is you and I have been delivered out of darkness and translated in the kingdom of the dear Son. Once again, that's an interface. That's an interface. It doesn't mean like now we no longer have to come up or confront all that is in the world. We do. We have to confront it. And it's always this interface. All that is in the world. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. It's not of the Father. But you and I have the love of the Father in us. Huh? Anybody has those things in them? Love of the Father is not there. I mean, they're the plain reality of light and darkness. Truth and lie, God and Satan. We need to get that absolute with these things, people, if we will. If we'll just say, listen, if we'll sell out to say God is faithful to his promise, I'm going to live by his word. I will not tolerate anything in my life. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
I'm not going to say, I'm not tolerating anything in your life. I'm not going to tolerate anything in my life. It is contrary to the word of God. And I'm going to get on you and encourage you. Don't you tolerate anything this time. Hallelujah. Of which salvation? The prophets, Elijah, Enoch, the prophets of old. What great and famous prophet? Obadiah, Isaiah, Jeremiah. These men of God who walked with God, who had a measure of the anointing being expressed in their life. They inquired, searching diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come. They went on a search, they went on a pilgrimage.
They had a revelation of what's been made available to you and me right now that we don't know how, for some reason, because we've listened to a bunch of lies and had a bunch of false models and are not willing to come under the authority and the reign of the Holy Ghost. Something that is available to us that somehow we've not been willing to take hold of because we're all busy with our own issues, fighting for our own causes.
About time we take up the cause of the cross, the cause of the kingdom. It's about time we understand that fundamental feature. Every time Jesus is recruiting anybody to advance the kingdom, his first thing he's doing is giving them the ability to deal with unclean spirits and demon spirits, to have authority over them, to cast them out. People, we have to be partakers of this, our own selves, because if we're brought under their authority, then we're just slaves, and they don't have to listen to a thing we've got to say. We'll go ahead and take a hold of the authority that God has given us to begin to walk this thing out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Take dominion over your temple, over your body. Amen. Quit getting pushed around in Jesus' name. Searching, verse 11, what manner of time the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of the Lord Jesus, the Spirit of the living God, which was in them, did signify when he testified beforehand of the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. Here we're standing right now in the midst of the glory that should follow. The Lord wants our eyes to be open so that we can be able to see what his inheritance is in us. He looks at James and he sees 30 nations, a half a billion souls. That's his inheritance. But he sees beyond that. He sees beyond the testimony and the signs and the wonders and the miracles and the declaration of heaven being revealed to people's lives. But he sees what you're going to be doing with him 10 trillion years from now, who he's making you to be in him. Come on, people. You need to get your write out your 10,000-year plan and see if your 5-year plan matches up. You need to write out your 10,000-year plan and see if your today, your tomorrow's plan matches up. Are you working towards that ultimately, that goal of what's most important to you? Yeah. And it doesn't really even need to be 10,000 years, 200 years. I don't want to mess with anybody's faith. I had a man of God come to me the other day. He's 80 years old. He looked good. He said, yeah, when he was a young man, the Lord told him he was going to live to 120. I don't have any doubt about it. The guy looked good, and he was tracking, he was thinking and acting like a younger man. Come on. So maybe some of you had a revelation that you're going to live to 200. I don't know. So I'm just kind of walking soft. I don't want to walk over top of your faith in God. I want you to get big faith in God. Hallelujah. But it ain't going to be long. You know, I saw this go on beyond that 300-year plan. I think it would be wonderful if God's people would step into a realm of walking in divine health. Amen. Hallelujah. Mosataya. Divine power. Yes. In such a way that you have some 200-year-old Christians walking around looking like they're 40. Amen. Huh? It gets some people's attention. Signs and wonders and miracles are a good thing.
Amen.
I know of a guy who taught and preached and ministered on divine health. He never had a decay. He never had a cavity. Never had a cavity. Somebody asked him one day, he said, how is it that you live in such amazing divine health? He said, I follow and obey the word of God. The scripture said, keep your tongue from evil and your lips that they speak no guile. Depart from evil and pursue peace. And so he gave himself never to speaking evil, any deceptive, any wrong thing from his mouth. Come on, people. Won't we just go ahead and start living out the word of God? No. We're silent when it comes to praise, but we got a big yapping mouth when it comes to complaining and talking bad about something. Come on, people. We're going to shut that thing down. Come on now. Everything is going to come under the rule. I said everything's going to come under the rule. Everything's going to come under the rule. Everything's going to come under the rule. Everything's coming under the rule in this place. See, we're just going to agree with it. We're going to get on it. We're going to get on the same page. Huh? You got to be willing to say, come, Father, shine the floodlight of heaven upon my soul. Let the word rip me to pieces. Because it's sharp. It cuts stuff up. It divides asunder joint and marrow, soul from spirit, thought, discerner and thought, the discerner of the thought and the intent of the heart, because we are naked before him. But then we have to do. Everything is revealed. There's nothing hidden. And whatever needs to be addressed and whatever needs to be dealt with, I'm here to participate. Come on now. Are you searching diligently? He's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Diligence is going after something diligently. Is an expression of that you desire it, you've got to have it, you can't live without it, you covet it. Searching water, what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them to signify when he testified before him the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow, unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves but unto us they did minister. They couldn't have climbed Mount Everest to get it. It wasn't for their day. There was nothing that they could do to have it. All they could do was stand there under the anointing of the Holy Ghost and the splendor of the Spirit of the Lord and prophesy these things out. And most of them would give their life just prophesying this out. Just because they talked about it, just because they declared it, they were killed, sawn in sunder. Huh? Suffered cruel mockings. You read about them in Hebrews chapter 11. And here you and I, dear people, are in that day. They was revealed to them that not unto themselves they ministered these things, but unto us, which are now reported unto you. These things that are now reported unto you, both by the scripture and by me tonight. Because I'm just in a long sequence of preachers. Going all the way back to Christ Jesus. A long sequence of an uninterrupted series of evangelists and pastors and prophets and apostles declaring to you this good word of God that is being preached right now, this gospel preached by and with the Holy Ghost who's been sent down from heaven, which things the angels would love to be able to participate with. That they sit on along, they sit on the sideline, as it were, looking at you with all earnestness going, you have all the power of God. When are you going to do something? Looking at the church that is supposed to be a testimony to all principalities and all the heavenlies of what it's like to be made one with God and be vested with all of his authority and with all of his power and be able now to have the equipment to stand up against the doubt, the unbelief, the onslaught of the powers of darkness, the spirit of Antichrist, the wickedness, to literally be, as it were, in a contest, fighting from the position of victory. Fighting from the position of victory. Fighting from the position of the overcomer. Fighting from the position of the one who's already more than a conqueror. Fighting with a position. I mean, it's just like James was saying, Joshua had received the word that they were already dead. They were already killed. They've already won the war. You and I have already received similar word, or a similar word from heaven. It's been written out to us. It's been sealed in the blood of Jesus Christ. It's been testified by the Holy Ghost. All you and I have got to do is step up and begin to walk it out step by step, to be prepared unto every good work, to be taught of God, to be equipped by him, to be trained by him. And you're basically going to be dealing with you. You're basically going to be dealing with you. Your biggest battle is you. You have to learn to deny yourself. If you will, I'm telling you right now, if you'll just begin to say, I know, I resign now to no longer have a will in the matter. I'm going to live to do the will of the Father. Now, I've just now taken away my choice to do wrong. I've taken away my choice to agree with something or to believe something different than what God says. I'm willing to risk my entire life on what he said and declared. I'm willing to stand here. I'm willing to stand right here at the point of death, destruction, devastation, the loss of all, knowing that God is faithful to his promise. I want you to stand with me. Father, Okay, what do we have at a baptismal service? We're having a baptismal service on the 27th. I'm going to call out some people tonight here. I'm going to lay hands on you. I'm going to help you deal with the demon spirits that have been overrunning you. I'm going to try to do it in a very private way. Huh? I don't want you to walk out of here feeling overwhelmed. I want you to walk out of here feeling empowered. But yeah, you know what? Yeah, you got to get over yourself. God hates a high look. Arrogance is an abomination to him. Self-will is something he wants nothing to do with. That's it. He's like, I want nothing to do with it. The last thing I would ever want is Father to go, I want nothing to do with it. Last thing I ever want is Father say, depart from me, you that worked iniquity. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. A fellowship and relationship with Father. There's a labor. And there's a lot of people that they don't want to labor. They're just lazy. They say, don't expect me to go to work. I'm coming for vacation. I'll work for myself, but I'm not working for the Lord. God tells us to labor to enter into the realms of the rest. To be instructed, to be trained, to commit ourselves to these regions and these realms of divine glory and power, to be able to investigate that which has been hidden from men and now is revealed at this moment in time is going to cost you time on your knees. If you're not willing to pay, you don't even want to be a part. You've never really come to terms with the reality of the existence of God. You've been entangled with this world. You'll lose your own soul. What should it profit a man if he has a bank account and loses his own soul? Why should it profit a man if he gains the whole world and he loses his own soul? I look at these people that could have been reached, like Steve Jobs, died of cancer. As far as I know, there was nobody there to tell him and lead him, no one with an anointing to lead him to Jesus. Because I'm going to tell you right now, until you are washed to the blood, you are not good enough. You are not good enough. God will not accept you. The only means by which you can be acceptable to God is to be washed in the blood of Jesus Christ, to take a hold of the life-giving power that he gives at the price of his death. He was willing to die for you and me so that we could step into this grace. And now we're going to not be, we just want to be whatever, you know, feel good about ourselves all the time. No, he's called us to lay down our lives. He's called us to lay down our lives. He's called you to live as an oracle of heaven. I pray you get fiery. And you get fervent about the things of the Spirit. I pray you get Holy Ghost indignation in you. There's a violence on the inside of you concerning laying hold on eternal life. I pray that you get passionate about God. Because that's what God demands. He says, those who are lukewarm about this, so I'll spew you out of my mouth. He demands fiery. And he's talking, when he says, I want you to be hot or cold, he's talking about being on fire when he's talking about hot. And he's talking about our passion. When God talks about Holy Ghost and fire, he's talking about fire in our passions. There's a fire in a bosom. A fire in the person. You can see it. You can see it. When a person's got a fire in their belly about something, about what they believe in. It may be about gaining riches. It may be about gaining power. It may be about advancing a cause. But you can tell when somebody is just a follower, when somebody's got fire in their belly. Father's come to give us fire in our belly in a way that supersedes anything that could happen in a natural realm. But yet I see more fire in the people's bellies over some political cause, on some earthly cause, while the church sits around twiddling their thumbs wondering when Jesus is going to come. Wonder when they're going to get their way and somebody's going to recognize them, feel sorry for them, be more sensitive towards them, love them more. Jesus, come on. That's not going to be us. No. Alan, that's not going to be us. No. We don't need to be loved. No. We got enough love. We got all the love we can handle.
We got all the love we can handle. God and the Holy Ghost and the Father loving us so much, there's more love than we can handle. We all about loving. Somebody said, why are you going to Kashmir? Because there's people dying and going to hell. There's beautiful, wonderful people. I recognize that there's wonderful people. I recognize there's wonderful people like Allie and like my wife Ann and like Ruth Anna that don't know Jesus. And they're going to die. They're beautiful, wonderful people. They're going to die and go to hell. Spend an eternity without God because no one was willing to go. I'm going to do everything I possibly can do. One day, Carlos looked at me and was talking to me and says, listen, I've given my life. I've left my family. They all grew up without me, all my kids. I don't know how many souls he had brought into the kingdom by that time. I think around 6 million. He says, you can't reach the whole world. You can only do a part of it. I didn't listen to what he said. I love him and I honor him, but I didn't listen. I'm reaching the whole world. I'm not going to limit it. I'm not going to limit it. I don't believe in translation. You might be limited if you have to rely upon airports and airplanes. I'm going for translation. I'm going for finding some people. I'm going for finding some people that I can jam full with the Word of God. I'm still blessed with Kelly. He runs around. He runs around declaring the messages he got filled up with for 12 years. It's so radical, so beautiful. So proud of Angelo and Paulina. I know they're up in Idaho right now. They're just pouring out the things that God poured into them. They just said, we can't sit anymore. We got to run. I said, what took you so long? Ain't nobody can keep you here. I send you out in the name of Jesus. What all do you need? You need ordination? Here, let me ordain you. People are dying on the way to hell. There's people sitting in churches all over America, and they've not been empowered. They know nothing about what you know about. And I want you to understand, you're going to start doing more with what you got. You can't justify your state. Jesus. And I say that though in a context of this. You got to know him to do it. You got to do it not because the pastor screaming and hollering and telling you how to do it. You got to do it because you came into a place of knowing him and relationship with him and fellowship with him that caused love and faith to explode on the inside of you. See, You know what I feel tonight? The only way I can describe it is I feel the power that causes a world to have an encounter with the living God. That's what I feel. I feel that. I feel the power that changes everything overnight. That drives out all darkness where a bright and shining light begins to glow of heaven's glory. Oh, Masiteya Kina Mazalia, Botasina Motorita. I want you to just get passionate. I want you to get aggressive. Huh? I was thinking about that 22-year-old that ran the platform of one of these candidates, doing his thing, trying to get people to vote for him. And the guy was so passionate about shutting him down because he saw such a bully and saw somebody that was such a threat to America. So he tried to run through 12 Secret Servicemen to get up on the platform to deny this guy the ability to speak. That's passion. That's fire in the belly. 22-year-old. Man, I'd like to get him into the kingdom of God. He'll shake some stuff up. And I'm sitting around asking for permission. Well, what do you think? What do you think I should do? Well, I don't know. I've been thinking, but then I thought I shouldn't think anymore. Just confused. Well, I don't know. You need to get a hold of God. And then you'll know. You need to find yourself a place of seeking the Lord. You need to begin to labor to enter in the rest. You need to quit getting distracted with all the mess. Hanging out with demon spirits
and getting demonized with stuff. Weird. It's time you get excited about the freedom and the deliverance in the life that's been given. Hallelujah. 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 Father, I thank you for the great things that you're going to do through your servant's life right here. Great things. Great things. Papa's going to do great things through you. He's going to do great things to you. He is. Papa's going to do great things to you. Yep. Because you'd go anywhere, you'll do anything. People are going to be amazed when they discover who you are in Jesus. You watch. You just watch what Papa's going to do. For anybody who set their heart upon him to seek him. I'm just telling you right now, there's some of you in this place. I'm so blessed. I'm so thankful for you. I'm so proud of you. Because I see no wavering in you. I see nothing but consecration. I see nothing but preparation. I see nothing but you just being right now trained by God and for Father to take you into every place, any place, whatever place He desires to take you. You're going to go. You're going to go. And I'm so honored to be a part of that. I'm so honored to be a part of the Kellys that have left here. I'm so honored. So honored to be allowed to minister to you, to pour these things into you. And I'm going to demand. And I have the right to. I have the right to, because that's my job. My job is to help you understand how to walk with Jesus. How to walk in the anointing. Hallelujah. Spirit of the Lord is here. He wants to encourage you. He wants to make your heart so stout, so brave, so strong. He wants to make you very courageous. But you're going to have to hear His word. You're going to have to let your thoughts be preoccupied with His word. Otherwise, you'll never be courageous. You'll be constantly going from fear to fear, tossed to and fro. You need to be grounded and established tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Great things. Great things. Just receive right now. Just receive right now. Just receive right now. Rabba basotaranea sipikiandala basifritia. Satambala bakisiri namasatalola basotaranea. Era satandala vekianasi. Iri masutani. Jesus. Just tell the Lord that you come to Him, that you surrender everything that you have to Him. That you're ready to labor to enter into the rest like never before. You're ready. You're ready to give yourself over to be trained by Him, prepared by Him, fashioned by Him like never before. To do it His way, not your way. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Rabba. You take this place, you take this realm of praise, this realm of the anointing, this realm of prayer that's here right now, and you let it be transferred, right over, just translated as it were, right over into your tomorrow. Let these things go with you in your car. Let these things go with you in the places that you go. This realm of the ministry of the Holy Ghost. This altar call consciousness. This consecration that is here in this place right now, you just let this go with you and watch what happens. Watch what God will do. Hallelujah. Watch what God will do. I'm getting ready. I'm gonna pray for everyone here tonight. I'm gonna lay hands on everybody in this place, and I want to especially give an invitation to those of you who've never had an encounter with Jesus Christ, the King of Heaven. God, the Holy Ghost is here to introduce Him to you. And if you respond to Him, He will come into your life with such an extraordinary, glorious power. An extraordinary miracle will take place, and He will come and take up residence in your life. He will give you a new heart. He will give you a new spirit. He will fill you with His love. He'll fill you with His joy. He'll fill you with a vision and a purpose to live out the life of God, to live out the life of heaven. You'll never be the same, and you'll never want to be the same. Hallelujah. And I tell you, and I feel that way about every time I'm in the meeting. Somebody said, you said that last time. I feel that way every time. I was just with Debbie Rester, up in Washington. We're going to go back there. We're honored to be able to go and minister at their conference in August. And she said to me after the meeting was over, her husband has been ministering most all of his life, preacher. And they came after the meeting and said, I'll never be the same again. I was so changed by the power of God tonight. This is our life. We lay hold on the things of heaven. We're so desperate for the things of God. We're so desperate. The more you give yourself over in relationship with Him, the more you give your time to interaction with Him. I'm telling you right now, if I could just get people, for example, to give themselves 1 year to having a time of prayer, to whether they're faithful to do it, your life would be so radically and gloriously filled with heaven that you can't even imagine it. Huh, baby? Ain't nobody gonna tell you to go there. You run to it. You'll run to that realm. It's a realm of glory that Satan has been able to fortify you against. And he uses your choices, yourself, your issues, your wants, your things, your prioritizations. And I want to help you get out of that, because you'll never do anything for God until you learn how to rely upon Him. And you're never going to rely upon Him until you're willing to take up the opportunities you have, relationship opportunities that you have, to get real close to Him, to get huggy, to let the... See, what happens is we begin to give ourselves to the Lord in prayer and thanksgiving. What happens is we begin to allow God to take a hold of your children. We begin to allow God to have free course through our life. And as we do, that coursing of His Spirit becomes stronger. It becomes stronger because it's as though God has liberty to move through us. Instead of being shut down because we're busy with our own stuff. You got to get this, people. I'm not talking about some kind of dual nature. I'm talking about the reality of self versus letting God live. It's either your life or His life. He transforms your life and told you to come and present yourself a living sacrifice, an offering to Him, to where that you no longer live. You submitted to Him and yielded to Him. I pray tonight in Jesus' name that you'll make the commitments that bring change. It's like someone said, how many of you want change? And everybody raised their hands. And the next question was, how many of you willing to change? And nobody raised their hands. Everybody wants change, but nobody's willing to change. Mando de esipa. Don't you want to look like... Don't you want to have the beauty and the splendor of heaven rather than to be shrouded with that which looks demonic? I look at some of these people, they get themselves all suited up and fixed up. They're supposed to be the glamour kings and queens. They look demonically ugly to me. All I see is demon power. I see nothing beautiful. Show me some old gray-headed woman who spent her life in prayer. I tell you right now, that's shining beauty right there. Hallelujah. It won't be long, and you're going to be 70, 80 years old. It won't be long. It'll all go by. It's like Allie said yesterday, the other day before yesterday, the days are long, but the years are short. It's true. I pray that you just step over people. Father's looking for somebody. He's looking for a people who will seek him. He's looking for a people who will give themselves over to him. We're not calling you to some boring, disciplined life. We're calling you to a heavenly life.
Amen.
Just before we lay hands on all of you and pray for you, I want to do something. We've got these cards, and it's the MTC Church Building Pledge Card. And about right around $18,000 has been pledged up to this point. And we need to see $60,000 come in to build the church. And, you know, we got great plans with the church. We're going to do everything that God gives us to do to go and reproduce the things every place God gives us opportunity. And this is one of those places. And so we want you to be a part of it. If you've not pledged yet, please do so. Be a part of this. Because we don't need all of the finances until July when we're actually putting up the structure. But we're going to need about 50% of the finances about 2 months out from July. So about middle of May. At the latest, it would be better for us to have it at the beginning of May. And so we're still probably, you know, we're still around 12,000 short of half of what we need, right? Thereabout. So if maybe you didn't pledge enough, you can get another card. Pledge more. Amen. And, you know, these things happen out of the fire of revival, out of the fire of the move of God and fellowship with the Lord in you. When heaven is first in your life, then it's no problem to do this, to give less away. When heaven's not first, it's a sacrifice. Are you with me?
Yeah.
It hurts bad. But when it's relationship, my mind, it's no sacrifice at all. It's fellowship.
Amen.
And it's no loss. It's multiplication.
Amen.
Come to you.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
So I want you to reach into that. And that's not even to talk about what all the finances that we're going to have to see come in for all the things that we're going to be doing. The crusade in Cuba alone is, you know, right at about $60,000 right now. Hallelujah. I'm excited about it, aren't you?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Well, Pastor, we'll just pray that you'll have the faith. No, you ain't going to do that either. You start moving in God. Amen. Hallelujah. It's relationship. It's not going to happen outside of the context of relationship. Knowing him, knowing him is knowing how all this works. Should I say again? Knowing him is knowing how all this works. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I know Geneva. I know that Geneva and David, I think you guys did something. You put something like $20,000 or $30,000 on your card for Nepal, right? It was a lot of money. Something like that, right? You don't remember? That's pretty good, you know, you didn't spend that kind of money and not remember. But at any rate, praise God for that. Praise God for people that are just going to step up. But look at what we did. Look at what the nation, well, look at what happened in the nation. I mean, Ann and I were willing to go risk our lives. All of a sudden, all you had to do is risk some money. Hallelujah. Make souls bigger. Make souls bigger than whatever else is big in your life. Praise God. Hallelujah. And so tonight, there's one thing I want to do. I'm going to receive two offerings, okay? so you can visit two baskets, okay? So in this basket right here, or somebody's already put an offering, I'm going to change it. This basket right here is for Pastor James Levesque, pastor, evangelist, apostle, prophet. No. I never know what to call James. That's why I just say James. And so, aren't you just thankful for James?
Yes.
An 18-year-old kid who read the Bible and said, I want to do this.
Yes.
And literally, he literally has. I mean, James runs in all the circles. He's an amazing itinerant evangelist who God has blessed with so much favor to have impact all across this nation. 18-year-old kid from nowhere, Connecticut. What will God do with you? Anything you'll let him do. And he started his ministry with a greasy pork chop and a half a potato. It's true. He did this. He started his ministry. Because that's all he had. I got a half pork chop and a greasy potato. I mean, a greasy pork chop and a half potato. Beautiful. It's a testimony to everybody. People, you got a great cloud of witnesses. Come on now. Come on now. You can go ahead and have a bunch of kids and make that your ministry, but they better all prophesy. And if you don't raise them right, they're not going to do that. Jesus. So when you pass by this offering basket, listen to me. When you pass by this offering basket, this is for James. Okay? And when you pass by that offering basket over there, that's for the church. And so if you haven't done one of these cards, and you know, we have a lot of things that we're doing right now. Everything that we do, listen to me. Some of you don't understand this. Some of you do because you've really supported what we're doing. You know, it's like people who go and buy other produce and thinking, why do they do that when we have so much? Because what we're doing with sustainability on the Mission Training Center, it all goes to the ministry, man. People's like, what's going on with the money? Give me a break. Do you realize how many bills we have? What are we doing with the money? Goodness. You know. So I really want you to participate. I want you to understand what's going on. If you don't know what's going on, there are people that can tell you what's going on. We try to send out emails about what's going on. Come on, dear people. Hello. 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 Hey. I know what the solution is. You get yourself so caught away in relationship with Jesus, and you will be filled with everything that's going on in the kingdom. And you'll be excited about everything that's going on in the kingdom. Otherwise, you're going to look on going, oh, there's something else we got to do. Yeah, you need to go conquer the whole world for Jesus. Get going. You need to go into all the world and preach the gospel. All the world. All. And say, so you go into some of the world. Are you listening to me? You are getting, listen to me, you're getting to be a part of things that are going into all the world. I'm going to say it again. Some of you look so sad. This means you don't agree. Okay? Some of you look so sad. Hallelujah. Get happy. Hallelujah. Just do that. Start talking about people's money and they just start shutting down on you. Start turning into stone. Don't do that. Don't act like an idol. Don't act like an idol. Covet God, don't covet money. You cannot covet God and covet money. You cannot serve God and money too. I'll break this thing down for you. You cannot serve God and serve money. You cannot, you cannot, you cannot. You can say, oh, well, I disagree and it doesn't apply to me, but it does. God's either getting your money or you're getting your money. Yeah. Amen. Somebody said, oh, he's talking about our money. Yeah, I am. Talk about your heart, too. We heart people. Where your money is, that's where your heart is. Amen. And if you'll covet and desire to do more,
with your finances. Listen to me. If you'll covet and desire to do more with your finances, God will, in the kingdom, God will give you supernatural faith to produce supernatural finances. I know people that are doing things, they don't have half, a quarter of the intelligence of some people in here, and they are just doing landslide deals and doing making unimaginable amount of finances. Just in the realm of a human, just in a human realm. And people are paralyzed with their self stuff. They haven't been willing to get over into a relationship realm with God. They've limited themselves. They're not willing to take risk. And so here we go. Father don't need a lot of people. He just needs people, just a few people full of faith.
Amen.
Praise God, he's got me. Got Anna, got Allie, a couple other people over here waving at me. Praise God. You need to get in. Don't be shy. Don't be Gideon. Be Joshua. Are you with me? Gideon turned to idolatry in the end. Joshua didn't. Joshua ended well. Don't be Gideon. Be who, me? Yes, you. Somebody said, well, how can I do that? Because you agree with God's word. You don't know anything or believe anything except what God said about you. He said, you are great. He said, I'll make you great. You're in me and I'm in you. He says simply, if you'll abide in me and you'll let my word abide in you. Come on, people. His word. What it is he said. It's in your heart. It's in your passions. It's in your emotions. What you believe. It's what you think. It's what you process. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I don't know, man. I haven't even started recruiting anybody to come to work yet. As far as putting the church up, the building up. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Listen, Ruthiana, just forgive me for not getting more ferocious about what you were dealing with quicker. Huh? Sometimes I'll let things go for just a little while, and then all of a sudden it's like, I'm done, man. And don't get in my way. When I get this way, don't get in my way. I might be small, little, kind of little looking, but you watch out, because I'm telling you right now, there ain't no way to stop me. There ain't no way. There ain't no way to stop me. The devil knows it. And I pray that he knows that about you. I'm going to get on. I'm going to run every harassing, tormenting thing off. You know what's more important to you than anything else? And many of you don't fully realize it. You making heaven. That's more important to you than anything else. You making heaven. You know what's next and more important to you? All of the people that God could use you to reach. And we have set our heart on developing a youth ministry that will affect this entire nation, and especially the Western United States, out on the Mission Training Center. We have set our heart to be able to see it, to start with 100 kids come through the Mission Training Center each week. And what do I see? I see souls. I see souls being touched by heaven. And then be able to glean out of those that give their life to Jesus and come back for other more advanced, you know, youth camps and mission camps. How do you see yourself reaching the lost? You've got to understand it. How do you see yourself reaching the lost, first of all, in your hometown, in your home community? Because this is what God says. This is the plan that he demands that we make. He said, first in Jerusalem, then in Judea, then in Samaria, and after that, the uttermost parts of the earth. And if you're not making that plan, you've never really began to be serious with God. Never begin. It's all about you. It's not about heaven yet. You're going to have to get serious. Come on, Jeremy. That's right. Come on. Talk to me now. Praise God. I got one person talking to me. Bring it. I guess you got to draw on these things. If you don't draw on the anointing, you're never going to get any. If you're not drawing on the anointing for healing, you're never going to have any. If you're not drawing on the anointing for faith, you're not going to have much. If you're not drawing on the anointing for the gifts of the Spirit, you're not going to have them. If you're not drawing on the anointing for the Word of God, the life of Jesus to be manifested in you, you're not having anything. You wasted your time. It's true. You wasted your time. Draw on it. You draw on it. You've got to have it. And if there's people in here you don't have that passion, it's an oppressive evil spirit. And I'll break it off of you tonight, but you're going to have to make a decision about changing. About putting God first in the realms of how you learn how to talk with Him and walk with Him. Because you can't go sell all that you have till you see the treasure. You can't go, come on. You got to see the pearl first. Hallelujah. 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 Get your Jerusalem plan. How are you going to touch people? You can come and ask me about it. I have all these things. It's not like I'm asking you to do something that I wouldn't do. I can show you my Jerusalem plan. You're it.
Yeah.
Here's my Jerusalem plan.
Amen.
And you can hook up with this, make this your Jerusalem plan too. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I can talk to you about Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the earth tonight as well. Amen. You need to get your own Judea and Samaria. You can hook up with me in it. But you need to get to work. You can't just sit back at home, watch me do all the work. Amen. Throw me a few coins. Amen. Work harder. Somebody said, we're praying for you to have the strength of 10 oxen. Well, great. Great. No, I'm not kidding you. Isn't it true? We pray that you have the strength of 10 oxen. My goodness gracious. Could you throw in a little bit? Now, I mean, I don't expect Reinhard Bonnke to come and help me. Look at, he's doing plenty. I don't expect James to come and help me. He's doing plenty. I don't expect Pat to come and help me. He's doing plenty. I can go down the list. But when you're not doing anything, or you're barely doing something, and come on and get you in here, get in here now. Get in here now. Get in here now.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I got Kelly coming back to help in the camp.
Amen.
I got him coming back. He can be in Turkey for a while at the time, but he's got to get back over here. He's got to help out. Amen. So these things aren't hard. These things are opportunities. These are the opportunities that you have to grow in the things of the Spirit, to be engaged in that which is eternal. To have the reward that doesn't ever fade away, both here and in the life that is to come. This is where you grow and where you mature. This is what it's all about. If this isn't what your life is about, then you don't have the life. Your life is either all about Jesus or you're still just making a decision as to whether or not your life is going to be all about Jesus. But you know what I am? I'm a bubble popper. I'm all about dissipating fantasies and exposing truth. Say, who are you really? This is who you really are. You know what I'm saying? Amen. Hallelujah. Kipora satanameya. Woo. And I just praise God. We love the church. We love you. We love this ministry. We know what the enemy tries to do, but we have a greater one living on the inside of us. We have a greater authority. We want you to understand that. We don't want you to let the enemy run over top of you in Jesus' name. We want you to stand up with a ferociousness like a lion's face. You with me? With the authority of the living God. And don't be overrun. And recognize, people, we're getting ready to do something again. Hear me. That has never been done before. Again. When we step into Havana, Cuba, this year, to do a mass evangelism crusade, it's never been done in the history of Cuba. And you are probably going to get some opposition coming out against you. Get yourself in the Word. Dwell in Jesus and let His Word abide in you so you can ask whatever you want. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I tell you, faith for Cuba jumped up on the inside of me
when, like Nepal, I said, that's my nation. As soon as I saw, I'd asked the Lord for Cuba. I'd talked to the Lord about Cuba more than I had talked about the Lord to the Lord about Nepal. And when the opportunity came where we saw the embargo lifted and diplomatic ties restored, we said, Father, Cuba, we want Cuba. Lord, open the door. I command Cuba to open, and Cuba has opened. We will be there on June 9th and 10th to bring pastors together. And we'll decide then what time this year the crusade is going to be. So we're looking somewhere September, October is really what I'm feeling. And you know what? You have an opportunity to be a part of history. You do. You don't want to let these things pass you by and go, you know what, I really didn't do much in it. I didn't really sacrifice much in it. I don't even know if I spent more than an hour praying. You don't want to do that. Because then you may never get another opportunity to be a part of things like this. Mm-hmm. Come on, people. Yeah. Just imagine. I believe that the worst thing people can do is leave their work for somebody else to do. Yeah. So somebody else got to do their work and, huh?
Yep.
Your work.
Yep. Yeah.
That's wrong.
Yep.
Yep. Just wrong. Yep. We're looking at you. We're looking at you. We're numbering you. So therefore, we believe that you're here because you're going to work.
Amen.
You can't sit around over there and sip tea while the rest of us working. Because we counted on you. We numbered you in the workers, not in the tea sippers. Amen.
Amen.
Now what's going to happen with the prevailing prayer, and suddenly we do a national crusade in Kashmir, which everyone said cannot be done, ever. That's what the same thing they said about Nepal. I'm going to go spy out the land. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, I am set. I am set. I am set. And I know what God's going to do for everybody that helps me. I know what He's going to do. I know He's going to bless me. And I know He's going to bless everybody who helps me. Because He's like, I don't have anybody else going. I have tried to find one single person going to Kashmir. I cannot find them. I've searched everywhere. I've networked with everybody. Nobody. You can't go there. Oh, I'm going. You are. You're going.
I'm going.
You're going, baby. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. She's going. I guarantee you she's going. You know, that look right there, I know that look. That ain't like question mark in one eye, exclamation mark in the other. You know, or question mark in one eye, a dot, dot, dot in the other. Oh, si patelea, man. And I'm happy for her to go because I got to have people full of the anointing. I can't have people going with me, man. You can't count on them. You don't know whether they're going to be high or low. You're going to get run over by the devil. You're going to come home with cancer. No, I'm not kidding you. I'm not kidding you. Because Satan's out to kill and to steal and destroy. And people don't know how to seek God and flow in the anointing and keep God first. You won't make it. I promise you, you won't make it. Not on this field. You have to start two hands for beginners. Huh? This is taking nations. This is anointing to take nations. I have an anointing to take nations. Father gave me an anointing to take nations. I've asked the Lord over and again, why San Diego? Why do you keep saying I have to go back to San Diego? Because Father keeps telling me that he's got plans. And I know what He's saying. I'm in favor to Him. And sometimes it isn't easy. But I'm faithful. I'm going to be faithful. I'm going to rejoice in all my tribulations. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I know a big part of why I'm here. Because I see the looks on some of your faces and I know where you're going. You're going places. You're going to be raised up by God. There are people that have left out of this place that are moving in signs, wonders, and miracles. Praise God. She's going. You heard her. Yeah. She's going. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Astomania pataya. No. You see that look on my face? That's determined. You have to have that. You have to. You have to. It ain't determined about all this other stuff. It ain't determined about taking on an army. It's something bigger than that. And it takes the absolute sold out determination. It calls every dimension of your passions and emotions to come to bear. Otherwise, you don't win. It causes everything on the inside of you to stand up and say, this will do, we will do this. Otherwise, it ain't gonna happen. You're just like, hey, you know, I'd like to do it. Forget about it. You ain't doing nothing. Because it don't work that way, not in this turf. You might dream about whether or not you're going to take a cruise. You'd like to take a cruise. But this that we're talking about here, you're going to face hell. You're going to face Satan and all his hordes. Praise God, we get to fight from the victory. I'm on the high ground. You're on the high ground. You are. You don't know how big you are. You really don't understand it. You don't know how big you are. You don't realize how big you are. The only way you can begin to understand how big you are is start looking at Jesus. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whole parts of Thailand that no one's allowed to preach in. And now the Lord's God has connected with Thailand in another way. Whole areas of Cambodia, no one's allowed to preach in. Now we're going to start touching that area. I mean, I really never even thought about really going into Thailand. But now the Lord's beginning to open up doors for Thailand, for Cambodia, for Laos. Laos is a fortified. Laos is fortified against the kingdom of God. Father's opening up doors in Laos.
Amen. Amen. Go on.
Thank you, Jesus.
That's why I say, you know, I'm not going to say you can't do the whole world.
Amen.
It depends on how many people are willing to respond to the gospel and how many people are willing to be assigned, because I know this is the reason. Over and again, we go into a nation and we'll have opportunities to where that we would spend our life there. The first time I went into China, I still have the pile of cards. I have a pile of cards. Because all the primary leaders of the house churches of China from all over China were gathered together in Nanyang. And everybody wanted me to their network. It would take the rest of my life to get to their network. That's well over 150 million people at the time. The Lord said, no, back to San Diego. Back to go speak into David and Heather's life. Get back over there. I'm raising Annalyn up. And you, Jacqueline, Zoe, Clara, Katie, all of you. Anybody who wants in, all of you. Faith Dominique. Buck Urina Makia Pata. Pato yena masipaya. Ah, persisitera. Ha, 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 lamanaseya. Ha, lamanaseya. Ha, lamanaseya. Over the next 200 years, I believe with all of my heart that the Mission Training Center will raise up more missionaries than any single organization on the planet over the next 200 years. And that's what we're doing. That's what we're building for. That's what we've structured. That's what we're setting up.
Yes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
And we're excited about it, aren't we? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We're excited on Monday. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, for great, big, Holy Ghost, God kind of dreams.
Yeah.
Huh? Yes. Praise God for great, big, Holy Ghost, God kind of visions, not sitting around a little room, you know, confined to some little place. And then the larger your vision, the larger your capacity to receive in the dimensions of the giftings and the exploits of God. Smaller vision, smaller capacity to receive that which God is supplying.
Yeah.
I want these works and greater works.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And we shall have them, for Father wants them for us.
Amen.
And all we must do is obey. All we must do is follow the spiritual, the rules. And there's the laws of the spirit of life that are in Christ Jesus. If you follow the laws of the spirit of life that is in Christ Jesus, you are free from the laws of sin and death. The laws of sin and death cannot apply to you when you're walking in the laws of the spirit of life.
Amen.
Hear me.
Yes.
Hear me.
Yes.
I'm going to say it one more time before because I'm just talking in the faith realm here. See, help you understand. There are rules to obey. There are things you're going to have to do. You don't ever get any of this. None of this belongs to anyone who's not willing to obey. You walk in the laws of the spirit of life that are in Christ Jesus, and the laws of sin and death do not apply to you. They cannot be imposed upon you.
Yes.
Satan will try to.
Yeah.
That's where you have to recognize your authority and stand up and go, what?
Yeah. Amen.
Are you kidding me?
Amen.
Smash you.
Amen.
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 They kind of got the fear of Grandpa.
I don't want him to, you know. I do want him to. But I don't want him to. See, the fear of leadership is good. I know that because Father wants us to have the fear of the Lord. Fear of leadership. There's consequence. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But we know that we can entrust that because it's all love. It's all about love. It's all about our profit. We correct our children for our own profit, but He corrects us for our profit.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
He corrects us so we get blessed. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He's correcting me so I get blessed. I love His correction. Huh? Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. I love your correction.
Amen.
Amen.
Even though, once again, it's not all about fun and feel good, because no correction for the time seems, no correction at the time seems, it just escapes you. Just take a guess. It starts with a ja. Amen, right. It rhymes with oyes. No correction for the time seems joyous. But afterwards,
yeah,
it yields
the peaceable fruits of righteousness. Hallelujah.
It's great having a partner who is an exhaustive concordance.
Amen.
If you want to know how it works, if I'm like hesitating on where the verse of scripture is, I kind of move over to this place right here so she can kind of whisper to me. And I walk back over here and act like I knew all the time. Hallelujah. Come worship the Lord. Right over here. Worship the Lord. James. Church. Ministry. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Now, Father, I thank You for working a miracle provision. Hallelujah. I can already see some of you giving huge offerings. I see it. Because I'm telling you, I know that some people, it's just a great sacrifice. And Father sees that sacrifice. I know some of you, you're not giving out of that your savings. You're giving out of your living. You listen to me. Father takes that and says, wherever this gospel is preached, this is going to be declared. I mean, it becomes a memorial for God. And I'm telling you, He's promised, and He's faithful who's promised.
You can count on him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, I want you to just come on and pray for everybody in the house. I just want to pray for you. Just come. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.